The future of my empire is found in the mysteries of life. How to hold on to it so that my reign will never end. And how to twist it to create colossi that will do my bidding. Not even nature can stand in my way. I will achieve immortality. Even if I am killed, I will return from the chaos of non-being to restored physical life. This even my master could not achieve. I knew it was so when I halted his breathing and watched the life vanish from his eyes. He sought the secret of life, to live forever, but I took his life. I remain the ultimate Sith. I have broken the spine of the galaxy. Nearly 100 years ago, the Yuuzhan Vong invaded, plunging the galaxy into deep chaos, bleeding and weakening it. Patient in the Force, I waited as the galaxy grew darker. I know the Jedi from old. They could never share my vision. 2 days ago, the Jedi Temple on Coruscant fell. Today, at their academy on Osis, the last of the Jedi will die. Sometimes things must be broken in order to be rebuilt. As I have bent the Force to my will, so I will bend the galaxy, and it will know order. My true work is about to begin. Greetings all, and welcome to the final episode of the Versus Series Season 7 here on the Evan Nova 95 channel. There's a lot to cover, so let's not waste any time. In this finale, we will be pitting the first Sith Emperor of the Galactic Empire, Darth Sidious, the primary antagonist of the Star Wars film saga and the Dark Empire trilogy, against the final Sith Emperor of the Galactic Empire, Darth Krayt, the central villain of the Star Wars Legacy series. As usual, I will draw exclusively on Legends EU material to evaluate all featured characters. Statements made by creators will also be considered if they are reputable and do not drastically contradict the narratives presented in their stories. While the thumbnail for this video depicts an aged Sidious wearing his Revenge of the Sith robes and a sick Krayt donned in his Vonduan crab armor, this is purely due to the more iconic nature of the designs. In truth, we will be examining Darth Sidious and Darth Krayt at the peaks of their strength, which featured them in vastly different forms and dress. For Sidious, this would be during the events of Dark Empire 1, specifically the 6th issue after he has inhabited a fresh clone body that he uses in his fight with Luke Skywalker and Leia Organa Solo. Although the Emperor does go on to appear in the preceding volumes of the story arc, he was significantly weaker due to inhabiting an unstable clone as the Skywalker twins had destroyed all of his best templates. As such, while I will occasionally reference the events of Dark Empire 2 and Empire's End as a means of clarification, I am not examining Palpatine under those circumstances. For Krayt, his peak would be during the events of the War Arc of Legacy after he has been reborn, with his body and Force abilities no longer restricted by the sickness caused by the Yorick coral seeds implanted into him by the Yuuzhan Vong. With all that out of the way, let's get started. Darth Sidious was a human male roughly 92 years of age at the time of Dark Empire 1. Although the exact origins of the human species in Star Wars are unknown, the prevailing theory was that they originated somewhere in the Deep Core, possibly on Notron, aka prehistoric Coruscant, and spread out from there. As specified in the Essential Guide to Alien Species, humans were a highly evolved race possessed of exceptional mental capacities, physical hardiness, and adaptability to sudden environmental alterations. While such traits were by no means exclusive to them, they were still considered extraordinary by the overall galactic standard, allowing humans to become the most numerous and politically dominant species in the entire galaxy, to the point where they were often viewed as the standard by which the biology, psychology, and culture of other species were measured. In terms of overall health, Sidious's physique belied his actual age due to him transferring his essence into a clone of the man he once was after his original body had been destroyed by Anakin Skywalker. As noted by the Dark Empire sourcebook, Sidious's clones took on three distinct forms over the course of the comic. An immature version, which is stated to be 15, even though he looks nothing like a 15-year-old, a mature version, which is the one we're analyzing since it's stated to be his peak, and an ancient version reminiscent of the old man we all know from Return of the Jedi. Although his mature body is never attributed an exact age, given the various statements and visual presentations, I think it's reasonable to assume that D.E. Sidious's physical age was somewhere in his late 30s to early 40s, and therefore still well into a Force wielder's physical prime. His decades of Sith training and battle experience crafting him into one of the most dangerous beings to have ever lived. All that being said, even Sidious himself has acknowledged that his clone templates were not flawless, as he was still saddled with the degenerative effects brought on by his sheer power in the dark side of the Force, with his mature clone still displaying the yellow eyes and deathly pale skin he had as an old man. Not only that, but as Sidious's power grew and each new clone got further and further from his original genetic makeup, his body would decay at an accelerated rate, which could be exacerbated if he used his full strength over a prolonged period. However, if his accolades and feats are any indication of anything, it's obvious that pushing him to his limit is not going to be a simple task for anyone in the franchise. He's not insurmountable, but compared to most people, he might as well be. Starting as always with Force-enhanced strength, Darth Sidious, despite not being renowned as a Sith of immense physical power, was still a beast. He was able to block attacks from Darth Maul and Savage Opress simultaneously, with Maul even noting that his former master was only experiencing a small amount of strain keeping the two brothers at bay. This is especially impressive considering how much stronger Maul has become since the Phantom Menace, during which time he was still cited as one of the strongest Sith Lords in all of history. Palpatine's most notable strength displays took place in his fights with Mace Windu and Yoda in ROTS, as well as his battles with Luke Skywalker in DE. While unable to overpower Mace, in fact he actually gets pushed back at several points, Sidious still held strong against the Master of the Order's attacks for an extended period of time. The dynamic was much the same in the Yoda fight. Although Sidious was unable to outright negate Yoda's application of Force Enhancement and could even be said to have been losing at a few points, he was still able to counter the majority of the Grand Master's attacks, with both being left exhausted when all was said and done. For reference, Mace Windu can punch hard enough to wind Carr Vastor, while Yoda can overpower Count Dooku, characters stated and shown to be comparable to Anakin Skywalker, the physically strongest prequel-era Jedi. Not only that, but Sidious was far weaker than he would later become in Dark Empire. Speaking of which, Palpatine would overpower Luke Skywalker in their first engagement and briefly hold his ground against him in their second before being defeated. Although Luke was nowhere near his prime and was also heavily nerfed by the Emperor's mind domination in their first duel, he was still leagues above himself from Return of the Jedi, who was strong enough to trade blows with a nerfed Darth Vader. Moving into speed, this is easily Darth Sidious's most impressive physical stat and the one he is most often cited for in his combative showings, We all remember the infamous sequence in ROTS where Palpatine speed blitzes Saisi Tin and Agen Kolar, with Kit Fisto being overwhelmed shortly after that. Although the novelization does add a few extra variables to this feat, along with other sources noting that Palpatine had conjured a dark side confusion haze that had preemptively weakened the Jedi, this is still a very impressive speed showing, considering that Saisi, Agen, and Kit were all noted to be amongst the greatest fighters the Old Order had ever produced. During the preceding fight with Mace Windu in the Chancellor's office, Sidious is described along with Mace as moving so fast as to appear to be fading in and out of existence from the point of view of a distraught Anakin, with the Chosen One stating outright that he could not fully perceive them. A similar situation occurred decades later with Sidious and Luke, the Dark Empire audio drama describing them as fighting at such speeds that even Leia could hardly see them. This is especially impressive considering she was in a better headspace than her father and was actively linking her mind to her brother's to aid him. For stamina, I'm just gonna be blunt and say that this is Palpatine's worst physical stat, and it's kind of staggering how bad it is compared to his other attributes. Now, just so we're clear, his stamina before DE was pretty good, as the only times we ever saw him push to his limits were in his fights with Mace and Yoda, which aren't exactly low bars. However, the Dark Lord's ability to sustain himself would change drastically after his original body was annihilated. As mentioned, Sidious's clones, despite being stronger than his original form, veered sharply from his natural genetic makeup, which, when combined with his monstrous dark power, caused them to decay at an accelerated rate. As I'm sure you can imagine, these factors drastically reduced the amount of time the Emperor could fight at full strength, as the more energy he expended, the faster he was consumed by his own corruption. Some have argued that this stamina problem only applied to the Emperor's unstable clone, and while it was certainly exacerbated, several sources have confirmed that this was an issue the Emperor experienced even when he was at his peak. We see it play out in the story when Sidious is left exhausted and rotting after Luke defeats him in a fight that did not last nearly as long as those in the prequels. Regarding durability, Darth Sidious doesn't have a huge number of feats to draw on since he tends to hold the advantage in every fight he's in, but that doesn't mean that the ones he does have are anything to overlook. He has tanked a blaster shot to the chest, and shrugged off having a cooling unit dropped on him telekinetically by Leia Solo. During his battle with Galen Merrick, Sidious withstood being slammed into a steel ceiling, blasted with Force lightning, and even survived being at the epicenter of Merrick's massive energy explosion, albeit not uninjured. By the way, all of the feats I just covered applied to Palpatine as an old man. Yeah. Moving into equipment, Darth Sidious has worn many outfits in his long and eventful life, though we are of course assuming that he is equipped with the same loadout he utilized in Dark Empire 1 during his peak. In keeping with Sith tradition, Sidious wore a set of close-fitted black robes reminiscent of the style favored by his first apprentice, Darth Maul. Despite the Emperor originally being taught that battle armor was a relic of the past, his perspective seems to have shifted in later years. His knee-high boots were reinforced with metallic plating, and he also wore a set of armored gauntlets that were shown to be strangely ineffective against lightsaber attacks. In contrast to his iconic hooded cloak, D.E. Sidious sported a near floor-length cape with a very Dracula-esque collar. The cape's only combative feature was its concealed chest plate and shoulder pauldrons. While these add-ons likely carried comparable durability to his gauntlets, I believe an argument can be made that they offered minor resistance to sabers, given how similar they were in design to the armor worn by Darth Vader. Darth Sidious's most notable tool was his lightsaber, which wasn't even his. Since his original Frick alloy weapon had been discarded, lost, or destroyed by the time of Dark Empire, Palpatine instead wielded one of his many trophy lightsabers taken from Jedi he'd slain. The weapon followed a fairly simplistic single-bladed design with no unique mechanisms ever demonstrated. Although the stylized artwork of the comic makes discerning the blade color difficult, supplementary material has confirmed it to be blue, strongly implying that it was powered by a set of Ilum sapphires due to the era in which it was likely built. While Asherad Head initially believed himself to be a hybrid of human and Tusken Raider, he would later discover that he was full human after learning that the two species were genetically incompatible. This would mean that the future Dragon of the Sith possessed a nearly identical biological makeup to Darth Sidious, with the only major differences being his age and the fact that he lived within his original body rather than a clone vessel. At the time of his final death in Legacy War, Darth Krayt was 185 years old, though, as with Palpatine, this number did not reflect the character's physical form. To prolong his sickness and preserve his rule over the one Sith, Krayt would spend many years in stasis while his mind explored the netherworld of the Force, resulting in him aging slower. That being said, his body is still stated to have had its expiration date enhanced far beyond the norm through Vong Biotech, with the Emperor stating that he had long since mastered Sith techniques for prolonging death. With that in mind, I believe that Darth Krayt's physical age could fall anywhere between his late 80s to his early 100s, depending on how you interpret certain sources. Regarding his physical health, Krayt's condition would take on many forms depending on the timeline. After his training under Zozan, the then-conflicted Sith apprentice was captured by the extragalactic species, the Yuuzhan Vong, and essentially turned into a guinea pig for their shapers. His left eye was replaced with that of an unknown creature, his prosthetic right arm, the result of his loss to Ben Kenobi on Tatooine, was replaced by a bio-grown substitute, and the core of his being was implanted with Yorick coral seeds. While the Vong initially planted the seeds as a means of making Krayt's body more amenable to their experiments, they eventually mutated the Dreadlord into a nightmarish biomass that could barely call itself human. Sharp coral spikes jutted out from his pores, slowly eating his internal organs from the inside out. This affliction drastically weakened the Emperor's physical attributes, exacerbated the effects of dark side degradation, and prevented him from accessing his full power in the Force. Although periodic stasis and healing trances did keep the disease at bay for years, Krayt's condition would finally reach critical mass during the Legacy comics, with him basically being at death's door during the climax of the Vector arc, a door that Darth Wheelock promptly blasted him through. Fortunately, Darth Krayt's condition would improve drastically after his rebirth, utilizing his newly acquired dark transfer ability to rid himself of the coral seed infestation and repair the damage wrought to his insides, regaining the physique of an aged but still devastating warrior. Moving into his application of Force-enhanced strength, Krayt was every bit the behemoth he presented himself to be. He displayed clear dominance over an amped Celest Mor despite being at the peak of his illness, and overwhelmed Wheelock after his rebirth. For reference, a weaker incarnation of Celest could briefly hold out against the strength of an early Dark Times Darth Vader, with Wheelock being shown to be far above the legendary Darth Andedu. Krayt was also depicted overpowering Cade Skywalker in both of their fights, Cade himself being strong enough to outmuscle hand-tier fighters like Darth Talon and Darth Nihil with relative ease. The Emperor's most impressive strength feats occurred during his and Luke Skywalker's two-on-one battle with Abeloth in the realm beyond Shadows. While incapable of directly overpowering the Chaosbringer, Krayt was still able to grapple with her at various points and even punch hard enough to puncture her stomach, the novel stating that the attack caused her severe pain. This may not have been an Abeloth at full power, but these are still monumental strength feats for Krayt, considering that peak Abeloth was a rival to the ones of Mortis. Speed-wise, Darth Krayt has a limited amount of material to draw on since he is more of a grounded fighter, however, that does not mean that the ones he does have are unimpressive. As a Tusken warlord, Asherad Het briefly kept pace with early Dark Times Ben Kenobi, albeit with some environmental advantages. As a Sith Emperor, Krayt could speed blitz Darth Nihil and tag the agile Cade Skywalker even by the end of the series. During Fate of the Jedi Apocalypse, Krayt matched his fighting pace with that of a prime Luke Skywalker and reacted to attacks conjured by a weakened Abeloth. That said, the Sith's ability to respond to the Chaos Bringer was clearly limited, as there were several instances in the fight where he was outpaced or blindsided. Though it's not like being a bit slower than the Mother of Mortis still doesn't put you in the godly tiers for speed. Scaling Darth Krayt's stamina is interesting because it's one of those cases where you need to fuse fact with supposition. As anyone who's read Legacy can attest, Krayt's stamina was, well, pretty terrible when his Vong illness was in effect. His relatively short bout with Cade at the climax of Volume 3 taxing him to where he needed to be put into stasis and was weakened thereafter. However, this compromised stamina would not be an issue for Krayt during the events of FOTJ or Legacy War due to him being separated from his physical body in the former and healed of his affliction in the latter. Although time has no meaning in the realm beyond shadows, Krayt and Luke's fight with Abeloth is still implied to have gone on for a substantial period, possibly several hours, with all combatants being left heavily drained when all was said and done. As for Legacy War, Krayt never displayed any signs of fatigue during or after his fights with Wirlock and Cade, which leaves his ceiling in his physical form a bit up for debate. Granted, he was stronger than his opponents, but it still speaks well towards the Emperor's fortitude that he can battle such high-caliber opponents and not break a sweat. Moving into durability, this is where Darth Krayt truly shined. During his imprisonment by the Vong, the burgeoning Sith Lord was subjected to an organic torture device known as the Embrace of Pain. Wrapped within its coils, Krayt discovered a new definition of pain and suffering, the device analyzing the electrochemical inputs of his nerve impulses to inflict a customized agony that was both optimum and constant. While most sentients couldn't survive the embrace for more than a few minutes, Krayt is implied to have held out for hours at a time, using his agony to strengthen his connection to the dark side and improve his ability to focus through pain amid battle. This demented endurance training clearly paid off, as the Sith Emperor would continue fighting even after having a bolt of force lightning shot through his chest and having one of his arms severed by Abeloth in their otherworldly melee. Krayt's ethereal durability is even implied by Mara Skywalker to rival or possibly exceed Luke Skywalker's, depending on how you interpret her dialogue, which is insane. Getting back to more physical feats, Krayt would be unexpectedly stabbed through the back by Azalyn Rey during his clash with a Myrrh Talisman-amped Celeste Moor, which caused him to be subsumed by their combined force lightning storm and blasted off a massive cliff, and still survived. Makes sense now why some people thought this guy was immortal. Shifting into equipment, Darth Krayt's kit was straightforward but far from mundane. His most iconic outfit was a set of gray Vonduum Scare Kyrick armor, which he wore to conceal his true identity and the severity of his illness. However, after his rebirth, Krayt would abandon this suit in favor of apparel more in keeping with Sith tradition. Though never shown in their entirety, he appeared to wear robes of gray and red eerily similar to the ones he had donned a century ago as a Jedi Master. His boots and belt were standard, and like Sidious, Krayt opted to rock a cape at the height of his power, though his was colored red and had a hood, so if nothing else, he wins that battle. The Sith Lord's armor featured wrist gauntlets, segmented torso plating, and spiked shoulder pauldrons. While the alloy used for his torso plating is unknown, it has also been demonstrated to be ineffective at stopping lightsaber attacks. By contrast, the pauldrons appeared to have been made from Vonduin material, much like his original suit. Also known as Vonduum Crab Armor, Vonduin suits were bioengineered by the Vong for their warrior caste. They were extremely durable, able to stop bullets and most standardized blaster shots with ease, and even offer resistance to lightsabers. That said, it should be noted that the Von Dune's ability to repel sabers was not unlimited, as focused strikes could pierce the crab hide if they were delivered with enough power, something the Emperor found out the hard way. Moving into weaponry, reborn Darth Krayt wielded two lightsabers which followed the traditional single-bladed model. His primary saber was constructed at an unknown period following his Sith ascendancy and featured a hilt composed of Yorick coral, drastically enhancing its durability. His secondary saber was the one he originally utilized as his primary during his Jedi days, which featured a metallic casing with a leather grip wrapped around the center and two leather-beaded tassels hung at the base. While his Yorick saber is consistently depicted with a red blade, suggesting that it was powered by synthetic Sith crystals known to potentially break the blades of other variants, there is some strange continuity regarding his Jedi saber. In Legacy War 1, the weapon retains the green blade seen during the Clone Wars. However, it is later depicted in Issue 6 with a red blade. One can rationalize this with the idea that Krayt swapped crystals, but the problem is that the hilt he holds constantly changes. At one point, he is literally drawn with three lightsabers, with his red blade somehow transforming from his original primary to his secondary in the span of three panels. As such, while the depictions of Darth Krayt wielding one red blade and one green blade is likely the writer's intentions, you can make the argument for different weapon sets. As I've said before, aside from their respective ages and the, shall we say, naturalness of their bodies, Darth Sidious and Darth Krayt have no significant biological variations. Both are humans who, at their peaks, lacked any cyborg support. With Krayt's Vong Eye never being stated to grant him special attributes, and his Vong Arm only ever matching the performance of his human one. As such, my conclusions for this verdict will depend on comparing their health, feats, and whatever benefits can be attributed to their gear rather than anatomical makeup. Conditioning-wise, both have trained in the Sith and Jedi arts longer than many sentients have lived, and both have demonstrated the capacity to fight in various environments, so that cancels out. Both also suffer from a level of dark side degradation that, at the outset, is comparable. Where things get tricky is when you turn our analysis inward. Darth Sidious's mature clone body is at least half Darth Krayt's age, which would typically provide a massive edge. However, the fact that his power usage heavily affects his integrity does come with disadvantages. Though not as big of a weakness in his DE-1 form compared to his Empire's End incarnation, Sidious's body is still inherently less stable than Krayt's, with his ancient form showcasing even heavier degradation than the Legacy Sith's reborn state. As such, while Sidious gets a slight health edge at the start of the fight, when the internal variables are considered, the factors generally balance out. Moving into strength, I would have to consider Darth Krayt's application of enhancement to be the more impressive of the two Sith Emperors by a fairly noticeable margin. ROTS Sidious contending with Mace Windu and Yoda is incredible, as is DE Sidious's ability to overpower a weakened Luke Skywalker. That being said, Krayt having the strength to wrestle with and punch through Abeloth to where she is left shrieking in agony is simply more impressive than anything his opponent has ever demonstrated, even when factoring in the Chaosbringer's weakened state. Remember, a being's spirit form in Beyond Shadows is an expression of the same force reservoir they use to enhance their bodies in the corporeal plane. Not only that, but Krayt's physical attacks were consistently portrayed as having a similar effect on Abeloth to those of FOTJ Luke, a Luke far stronger than the nerfed version Sidious was only able to outmuscle towards the end of their fight. Pretty straightforward. Less straightforward are the Sith Lord's levels of speed and agility. As I mentioned in their breakdowns, Palpatine is often praised for his swiftness, whereas Krayt tends to keep himself more grounded. However, the two Sith are fairly even when it comes to their actual displays. Both have blitzed council-level fighters with ease, and both have kept pace with some of the strongest characters in the franchise. Darth Krayt has been shown getting tagged more times than Darth Sidious, though most of those instances were when he was weakened, fighting gods, or caught off guard as he was with Cade. Speaking of the Jedi, Krayt tagging Cade in their duels showcases his ability to handle fighters who utilize acrobatic fighting styles. As such, while the Emperors are comparable in their speeds, with Sidious being more agile than Krayt, there is no reason to assume he's so much more nimble that he'd end the fight immediately. Stamina is a total domination for Darth Krayt, no matter how you look at it. Even when considering the superior quality of Palpatine's DE-1 clone compared to his Empire's End form, his unstable genetics still saddle him with limitations that his opponent does not possess. This stamina weakness is only relevant in fights with the best, but unfortunately for him, Krayt is on that tier, regardless of where you assume his ceiling stops. By the way, assuming is all we can do since we've never seen him push to his limit in his prime. Krayt also has the benefit of his battles in Beyond Shadows, which even lowballed surpass any stamina feats that Sidious has ever showcased or been attributed with. So, yeah, like I said, domination. Durability falls along similar lines of reasoning, though the gap is noticeably smaller. Sidious and Krayt have been subjected to many of the same injuries and have bounced back at very similar rates. However, not only has Krayt demonstrated a more consistent threshold for his toughness, but his ability to focus through pain in the fires of battle is simply on a different level. It is no exaggeration to say that this Emperor has persevered through some of the worst pain his universe has to offer, with his entire philosophy revolving around resolution through agony. As impressive as an old Palpatine withstanding Merrick's Force Explosion may be, it does not hold the same weight as Krayt persevering after having a lightning bolt shot through his chest by Abeloth, nor does it speak to a mental fortitude that is sufficient to survive the embrace of pain. Simply put, it's not a stomp, but Darth Krayt definitely has the advantage. Shifting into the combatant's gear, the two Emperors carried very similar kits. Both wore light armor and wielded single-bladed lightsabers without any unique internal mechanisms. While some components of Sidious and Krayt's suits have demonstrated vulnerability to lightsabers, we can at least say with some certainty that Krayt's pauldrons provide a moderate protection against such attacks, whereas with Sidious, it's pure speculation. As far as their lightsabers went, Krayt's primary utilized more powerful crystals and sturdier plating than Sidious's trophy. And there is the obvious factor of him having two lightsabers at his disposal, doubling his arsenal in comparison. Overall, when comparing the physical stats and attire benefits of Darth Sidious to those of Darth Krayt, what we have is essentially a glass cannon versus an actual military-grade cannon. Palpatine may be physically younger, initially, and more agile, but he falls short in virtually every other category. Krayt is more genetically stable, is bigger and stronger, is at least comparable in combat speed, has significantly higher stamina, can both withstand and endure far more damage, and has better offensive and defensive equipment. I award Darth Krayt the edge in physical capability and attire. Darth Sidious, also known as Emperor Palpatine, was the central villain of the Star Wars film saga, a series known to have produced some of the baddest bad guys in all of fiction. Having clawed his way to the top of galactic domination, he has faced some of the strongest characters in the entire franchise and come out on top. Starting with his mindset and accolades, Palpatine mainly viewed martial arts training as a means to an end, believing that the Sith had grown past the use of lightsabers, yet continued to use them if for no other reason than to humiliate the Jedi. Despite his frequently cited aversion to physical combat and preference for his force abilities, Sidious's saber mastery has received considerable praise from a large body of content. His fighting skills were called stunning by the Insider magazine, and he has been cited on numerous occasions for his extensive mastery of esoteric fighting styles and weapon types. In regards to martial scaling, Lucasfilm stunt coordinator Nick Gillard has repeatedly referred to Palpatine as one of the most skilled fighters of the prequel era. Longtime fans know that I strongly refrain from citing Gillard's leveling system for my scaling videos due to it being woefully inconsistent with the lore. However, I feel that broad statements like these are fine since they do align with the Sith's portrayal. If you desire something more concrete, Darth Sidious heavily implies during his battle with Mother Talzin that she would have presented a real threat to him had she possessed the same skill level as Count Dooku, who we know is a top-tier prequel-era swordsman. As far as his post-prequel accolades went, Palpatine doesn't have much. In fact, Vader is actually stated to have attained unparalleled lightsaber skills by the time of Force Unleashed 2. Which makes sense considering that the Emperor had basically sworn off swordplay and rarely left his palace at this point. Shifting into feats, Darth Sidious, as mentioned, has fought many of the top tiers of the franchise and lived to cackle about it. Shortly before the commencement of Order 66, Palpatine waged a titanic battle against the Master of the Order, Mace Windu, within the office of the Supreme Chancellor. Despite the ease with which the Sith Lord had slain the Masters Saisi Tin, Agen Kolar, and Kit Fisto, Windu ultimately triumphed, disarming and subduing the Dark Titan through a combination of his Vopad style and Shatterpoint abilities. Although many fans like to lowball this feat with the assertion that Sidious threw the fight, numerous guidebooks and even George Lucas himself have confirmed that Mace can and did directly overpower Sidious. Had it not been for Anakin's intervention, the only time where Sidious is confirmed to have held back, Mace would have ended the Sith threat then and there. There is also the aforementioned variable of the confusion haze that he had used to preemptively weaken Mace and his allies. All that said, this feat still speaks phenomenally well of Sidious's strength. Numerous sources have confirmed Mace Windu to be one of the strongest Jedi Masters, period, with swordsmanship being his primary attribute. Sidious may not have been the Qoran's equal as a fighter, but he certainly was not that far off, having pushed Mace beyond what he thought Vopad was capable of achieving. Jumping ahead to the climax of ROTS, the newly minted Emperor Palpatine waged a historic battle with the Jedi Grandmaster Yoda within the Senate arena. This clash far and away transcended anything personal between the two, the Lord of all Sith bringing his full might to bear against the Master of all Jedi. In the end, it was Sidious who stood victorious, unleashing a torrent of lightning that blasted Yoda backward to crash against the podium and fall into the wreckage below, forcing him to retreat. Now, this fight has a similar dynamic to Palpatine's fight with Mace, despite the polar opposite results. Although the Emperor did win against the Grandmaster, it was still an extremely close bout. Both combatants being heavily fatigued and damaged when the dust finally settled. Yoda does admit at one point that he was fighting a losing battle, something other sources have backed up. However, in terms of just pure lightsaber skill, Yoda is superior to Sidious. Not only was the Jedi shown visibly frustrating the Sith Lord, but the ROTS Junior novelization even depicts a sequence where Yoda disarms Sidious of his blade halfway through the fight, forcing him to rely purely on the Force from there. This is backed up by guides stating that Sidious's saber skills matched his foe's fury at every blow, with Sidious's strength in the Force being what ultimately netted him the win. That said, like Mace Windu, Sidious's performance against Yoda speaks volumes about his capabilities. There are oceans worth of content confirming Yoda as the strongest member of the prequel era council, the most skilled practitioner of the Ataru style, and one of the most powerful Jedi in the entire franchise. Palpatine may not have been Yoda's match as a martial artist, but again, he clearly was not that far off either, and actually managed to equal the Grand Master who had beaten one of his own apprentices years prior. Moving into the post-prequel timeframe, Darth Sidious doesn't really have too much to draw on until the events of Dark Empire, due to him relegating most of the combat missions to his underlings. The only time you can say he was even remotely tested was in his battle with Prime Galen Merrick at the climax of The Force Unleashed. Galen landed several attacks on the Emperor, but they didn't seem to be doing much, with guides stating that Merrick was simply not strong enough to overcome Sidious. Merrick only inflicted any appreciable damage when he employed his Force Explosion, an attack Palpatine survived, and Merrick did not. Still though, it's not like this feat was unimpressive. Pre-Prime Galen could defeat Dark Times Shaak Ti, one of the most powerful Jedi in history, with his Prime Self later besting Darth Vader. Vader may not have been at his peak and only lost due to him underestimating his former apprentice, but he was still much stronger than his Episode 3 self, which makes Galen's ability to fight him, and by extension, Sidious's ability to beat Galen, a feat that few could replicate. Jumping ahead a few decades to Dark Empire, we have Darth Sidious's feats at his strongest. During the climax of Volume 1, Sidious fought Luke Skywalker on two separate occasions. Their first bout took place in the Emperor's Biss cloning chamber after Skywalker had failed to destroy all of his templates. With a fresh body inhabited, Palpatine picked up one of his trophy lightsabers and charged the mentally unbalanced Jedi Master. The battle was vicious, however, Sidious ultimately came out ahead, disarming Luke and proceeding to break his will fully into the dark side of the Force. Their second battle occurred one issue later aboard the Eclipse Dreadnought after Leia Organa Solo successfully brought her brother back from the edges of the darkness. With his mind cleared and his aura re-energized, Luke would defeat Sidious in a titanic rematch, slicing off the Sith Lord's left hand and demanding he surrender. Not one to take defeat lying down, Palpatine unleashed a powerful Force storm to crush the New Republic once and for all. However, his efforts were thwarted when Luke, Leia, and her unborn son, Anakin Solo, joined their spirits into the Force and created a wall of light that severed Sidious from the dark side, causing him to be annihilated by his own power. Thus ended the reign of Darth Sidious. At least for 6 months until he came back in an unstable clone that was later shot dead by Han Solo, with his spirit being dragged into the depths of the Netherworld by Impato Jaos Brand, where every deceased Jedi would ensure that his essence would never return. Yeah. Okay, so as I think my descriptions made clear, there are several variables at play in both of Palpatine's fights with Luke Skywalker that need to be acknowledged. The first is that Luke was mentally and spiritually nerfed throughout the entirety of the first engagement. This element is most apparent in the audio drama, however it, the comic, and their supporting materials all confirm that Sidious had been gradually dominating Luke's mind and suppressing his connection to the light since issue 1 to make the Jedi Master more malleable to his teachings and potentially a new host vessel. Despite these restrictions, Skywalker could still successfully land hits on Sidious and give him what has been described as a ferocious lightsaber duel before being subdued, signifying that it wasn't an easy victory for the Emperor. That said, we also need to consider that Palpatine's body is implied to have been in its immature form during this fight rather than the mature state he would take on in the following issue, meaning he too was not at the apex of his strength. Moving into the rematch, the most contentious variables for this feat revolve around Sidious's and Luke's power levels, along with Leia's degree of influence. For Sidious, the scaling is pretty straightforward. As I said a second ago, the Emperor's clone body was in his mature form at this time, and therefore at its fighting peak. There is no question that this is the strongest incarnation of Darth Sidious in the entire series. Luke's scaling, though, is a bit more complex. While Leia dispelling the Emperor's mind domination over her brother is a consistent element across every version of DE, how much she contributed to the actual fight is a bit up for debate. Some guides have claimed that Leia amped Luke by directly adding her power to his, whereas the comic states that Leia unlocked a bit more of Luke's latent force potential, making him stronger. One is a temporary linear addition of strength, while the other is a more permanent unleashing of the inner power one has at their disposal. While I believe an argument can be made on both sides, when I look at the story across all iterations, I think the answer to this disparity is actually both. Luke, Leia, and Anakin were pooling their collective power when it came time to snuff out Palpatine's darkness. However, purely in the context of the duel, the lore seems to side more with the idea that Leia unlocked more of Luke's powers rather than amping him with the totality of her own. This idea is corroborated by the audio drama's depiction of Leia actively sensing Luke's light overpowering Sidious's darkness during their clash, as well as the fact file statement of Luke being too strong for the Sith Lord to defeat this time around. However, as I've said repeatedly, Sidious's loss in this instance does not present him in a wholly unimpressive light. At the beginning of Dark Empire, Luke Skywalker is stated to have grown immensely more powerful since Episode 6, being referred to as a Jedi of the highest order, which, depending on interpretation, could be taken as him already rivaling the top-tier Jedi of the prequel era. His scaling could go even higher depending on how you interpret the artistic and Lando Calrissian's comparisons between Luke and Darth Vader. Luke would, of course, become even stronger under Palpatine's tutelage and have more of his force potential unleashed by Leia at the climax of Volume 1. That is the Luke Skywalker Sidious fought, and that is the Luke Skywalker he only lost to after a short but intense battle. Suffice it to say, this is a combat feat more than deserving of top 30 status. Moving into technique and attributes, Darth Sidious was one of the most terrifying Sith Lords to have ever brandished a lightsaber despite his distaste for it. Possessing a wide-ranging skill set that was cultivated through decades of training and combat with some of the universe's heaviest hitters. As noted by multiple sources, Palpatine was a master of all seven forms of classical lightsaber combat, and although his core style is unknown, I would say the most likely culprit would be Juyo, given how it aligns with the Emperor's portrayal, and how he refers to it as a Sith style in the Jedi Path. As explained by that very book and others, the movements of Juyo were sharp and chaotic, employing bold, direct attacks more open and kinetic than the Jajem So style, but still less elaborate than those of the Ataru style. The art was extremely difficult to learn, with only high-level masters of multiple forms being permitted to study it. In addition to its technical complexity, Juyo also carried rigorous mental components, as it required users to draw upon their passions to fuel their offensives. These components in particular made the form understandably controversial amongst the Jedi, but a favorite amongst the Sith, hence the Emperor's association. Due to Juyo's emphasis on seemingly unconnected staccato attacks, the form was an optimal choice for fighters wishing to overwhelm foes quickly. It was also seen as the best offensive counter to the defensive style of Sarisu. That said, the form's wide movements did make it ill-suited to engage counter-centric styles and multiple opponents, with its mental attributes leaving practitioners more exposed to attacks from the Force such as TK shoves or pulls. Shifting into his actual means of battle, Darth Sidious's offensive technique was as sadistic and uncompromising as the man himself. In keeping with his duplicitous nature, Palpatine will adopt whatever fighting method he needs in order to bring his enemies to their knees. While relying purely on his swordsmanship was not unprecedented, he had zero qualms about overwhelming weaker foes with his force abilities, in fact he preferred it, nor was he reluctant to cheat in order to catch his opponent off guard. As far as his pure saber attacks went, Sidious's assaults have been frequently depicted as consisting of heavy cleaves, calculated stabs, and whipping slashes delivered at blinding speeds to eviscerate his target's defenses. He has also been shown adopting an attack pattern consisting of heavy-handed flourishes and pivot swings to pick apart an opponent's guard. However, this style only really came out when he employed Jar-Kai, which he doesn't use in Dark Empire. Undoubtedly drawing influence from his Ataru training, the Emperor often reinforced his saber sequences with integrated physical combat, having a particular preference for flying kicks. He was also extremely adept at pairing off his physical attacks with his force abilities in the vein of a Nyman master, telekinesis, lightning, and telepathy often being his preferences. Though his position on the galactic throne and his sheer strength meant that true equals rarely contested him, Darth Sidious's defensive capabilities were still very impressive. Despite his core form being naturally weak against groups, the Emperor had little issue utilizing Shi Cho-esque parries or even Trakata-style interceptions to guard against attacks from multiple flanks. When engaged in one-on-one battle, he relied on grounded, two-handed blocks and blade-binding techniques to cancel out a foe's forward momentum and leave himself primed to deliver vicious offensive counterattacks. The Emperor was also not above using jumps, flips, or simple sidesteps to dodge incoming strikes when necessary. All that said, Sidious was not exempt from the innate defensive deficiencies of the ferocity form. And it is worth mentioning that despite it occurring exclusively in fights with the upper tier of the verse, he has been disarmed in virtually every major battle he's taken part in. Moving into strategic prowess, Emperor Palpatine is an icon of the scheming supervillain archetype in popular culture, and for good reason. Befitting his utilization of dual identities, his mindset typically followed two distinct patterns. On the one hand, you have a calculated mastermind, a man who analyzes his enemies down to the most minute detail and then, with meticulous skill, proceeds to manipulate them into either joining his side or walking blindly into an unwittable situation. On the other hand, you have an insidious tyrant, a man driven by an insatiable hunger for power who will do whatever it takes to win, regardless of the potential consequences to others. These mindsets coalesced into battle tactics based on maintaining total domination in body, mind, and spirit. A consummate master of Dune Moke, Palpatine constantly bombarded his foes with taunts, witticisms, or proclamations of their defeat to cloud their psyches and keep them from bringing their full strength to bear. His other primary battle tactic was centered around pattern recognition and adaptation. Thanks to his vast knowledge of the Sith and Jedi arts, Sidious could recognize traits from almost all styles of combat and adapt his strategies to exploit their weaknesses, constantly changing his own style so that his opponents could never get a beat on him. All that being said, this strategic approach was far from foolproof. Just because someone can recognize the attributes of a style doesn't necessarily mean that they can circumvent it entirely. When faced with foes of equal or greater skill, Palpatine's adaptations mainly just helped him fight back, with these fallbacks, of course, being contingent on his ability to recognize the traits of his foes in the first place. Speaking of fallbacks, the evil Emperor was obviously not unopposed to using underhanded tactics, nor did he have issues calling on his minions to assist him when things got tough. Additionally, his ability to quote-unquote roll with the punches was severely hampered by his hubris. Due to his constant need for control, Palpatine did not take resistance well, often freaking out whenever his back was even remotely pushed against the wall. Fear leads to anger, anger leads to hate, hate leads to suffering, and all that. Darth Krayt, once known as the Jedi Master Asherad Het, was the central villain of the Star Wars Legacy comic books, a series that catapulted the franchise into the distant future and reinvented the Order of the Sith Lords in various unprecedented ways. Darth Krayt's character was shaped by the agony of death and the ecstasy of rebirth, defeating thousands of adversaries throughout his lifetime and facing the universe's greatest disasters without a moment's hesitation. Starting with his mindset and accolades, Krayt was a born warrior who viewed combat as both a necessity and a birthright. Although he played the games of deception as well as any emperor of old, Krayt's raw strength was the bedrock for his rule over the One Sith, and his martial prowess has been praised by loads of material. During the Clone Wars, Het was recognized as a master duelist in the Alien Henchmen of the Empire article, and showcased his exceptional skill with various weapons. His mastery of the lightsaber was such that even Ben Kenobi, one of the strongest Jedi ever, considered the Tusken to be a formidable opponent he had to take seriously. As a Sith Lord, Darth Krayt is noted to have honed his fighting techniques to perfection, surpassing all members of the One Sith, a feat that is insanely impressive considering that their strength rivaled that of the legacy New Jedi Order. Getting a bit more meta, Krayt was the prophetic dark man who haunted Luke Skywalker's dreams for years, and whose existence helped motivate Jason Solo to become Darth Kytus. I'll get more into the scaling between Krayt and Prime Luke later, since most of the lore revolves around their force capabilities. However, author Troy Denning has made a few tongue-in-cheek statements implying that the two were also comparable as swordsmen, which truly goes to show why the Dragon of the Sith is regarded as one of Star Wars' best fighters. Moving into feats, Darth Krayt, like Sidious, has faced many of the most powerful characters the franchise has to offer and come out on top. 2 years after the Old Republic's downfall, Asherad Het engaged in a fierce battle with the Jedi Master Ben Kenobi on the harsh terrain of Tatooine. Despite the desert being Het's familiar battleground and his skills enabling him to land several hits on the hesitant Jedi, Kenobi ultimately emerged victorious, disarming the war leader and unmasking his Tusken identity, thus disgracing him in front of his tribe. Het, in defeat, pleaded for death, but Kenobi instead chose mercy, making him vow on his father's honor to abandon Tatooine and never return, with the hope that Het would eventually realize his mistakes and embrace the Jedi way once again. Now, there are several variables in this battle, which, despite resulting in a loss, still underscores Darth Krayt's incredible abilities at such an early stage in his life. The comic book adaptation doesn't cover this in much detail, but writer Wyndham's novel, The Life and Legend of Obi-Wan Kenobi, does confirm that Ben's past friendship with Asherad negatively impacted his mental state during their battle. This hesitancy, combined with Asherad's advantage of fighting in a desert environment, played a critical role in the Tusken's battle performance. It is only after Kenobi gets his head in the game that he wins, which he does fairly quickly. However, the novel also notes that Asherad's skills did pose a threat to Kenobi that could have resulted in his death if he wasn't careful. As I discussed in my prequel Jedi Council ranking video, A New Hope Ben Kenobi was far stronger than his Revenge of the Sith self, having advanced his force and lightsaber skills to the point where he could fight on par with Darth Vader, who had long since surpassed ROTS Anakin Skywalker. While it is difficult to quantify Ben's growth between ROTS and the Het fight given that it took place just 2 years into the Dark Times, the fact that a pre-Sith Krayt could pose such a threat to him is exceedingly impressive, especially considering that Episode 3 Obi-Wan was a supreme-grade Jedi on par with Mustafar Darth Vader. Jumping ahead many decades to the Fate of the Jedi storyline, we have the first and debatably greatest of Darth Krayt's feats as a fully-fledged Lord of the Sith. At the crux of the war with the Lost Tribe, Krayt would battle the extremely powerful Force entity known as Abeloth alongside the Jedi Grandmaster Luke Skywalker within the realm beyond shadows during a period where her strength was diminished. This fight is often considered a highlight of the admittedly divisive book series, and it's easy to see why, given its uniqueness. As the realm beyond shadows existed outside the material plane, Krayt and Luke were forced to battle Abeloth as pure manifestations of their force energies. No weapons or armor, just physical skills and force powers. The fight defied comprehension, pushing all of the combatants to their absolute limits. Although Abeloth's ferocity was literally the stuff of nightmares, the Jedi and Sith duo gave as good as they got. Whether it was Krayt puncturing her stomach or sapping her strength with force drain, or Luke piercing her knee and rocking her with a force blast. Finally, after hours, days, or lifetimes of battle, Krayt and Luke, with the aid of the other Jedi, succeeded in destroying the Chaosbringer, her form dissolving into the Lake of Apparitions. As the two battered warriors rose and made their way to the shore, Luke proclaimed that the Sith would never rule the galaxy, and that Jason had succeeded in changing the course of the future. With a wicked grin, Krayt responded by stating that Luke knew nothing of their ways, and that they shall both see whether or not Kaidus truly changed the future, or simply delayed it. Now then, there are several factors we need to acknowledge regarding this showing. Firstly, it is crucial to stress that Abeloth was never at full power during the entire battle. As noted by Fate of the Jedi Vortex, Abeloth holds 12 times the power of Luke Skywalker. However, when Krayt and Luke later faced her in Beyond Shadows, the Chaosbringer had split her essence amongst multiple avatars spread across the galaxy. These avatars were then destroyed at the same time she fought the Sith and Jedi Masters, which diminished her even further. That said, we also cannot discount the fact that Krayt and Luke were able to severely damage Abeloth both as a unit and individually. This is further supported by statements in the Apocalypse novel confirming that Abeloth did fear Luke Skywalker and his potential to thwart her plans. Considering that Krayt is noted to be comparable to Luke, it's not far-fetched to imagine that the Chaosbringer would have viewed the Sith Lord with similar apprehension, an idea the battle supports. Even if Abeloth was only operating at 10% of her usual strength, this is still a godly feat for Darth Krayt, given that peak Abeloth rivaled the ones of Mortis, who are confirmed to be the physical avatars of the various aspects of the Force and the strongest of the Celestials. Moving into the Legacy era, we see Darth Krayt at his absolute best and his absolute worst. After generations of the Vong's coral seeds ravaging his body, Krayt's strength would steadily decline between volumes 1 and 6, being significantly exacerbated by his first fight with Cade Skywalker at the end of volume 3. As mentioned, the Dark Lord's affliction would reach a critical mass during the Vector arc, ironically where another of his major feats took place. During the Battle of Had Abaddon, Krayt battled the ancient Jedi Master Celeste Mor, who wielded the power of the Sith artifact known as the Myrrh Talisman. Although the Emperor successfully overpowered Morn, with Darth Maladai jumping in to aid him, the tide would turn when the Jedi finally surrendered herself fully to the spirit of Karnes Myrrh. The two great Sith Lords engaged in a spectacular clash of force power. However, the struggle was brought to an abrupt end when Krayt was unexpectedly stabbed through the back by Azalyn Rey, which caused him to be subsumed by his and Myrrh's combined lightning storm and blasted off a massive cliff. Miraculously, Krayt survived Myrrh's assault and the fall. However, he was given no opportunity to recover as he was then betrayed and seemingly killed by his regent, Darth Wearlock. Now, while this battle has an abundance of variables, their actual impacts are fairly straightforward. As I've said repeatedly, Krayt entered this fight the weakest he had ever been, yet was still rocking Celeste whenever she wasn't using the talisman, with Myrrh directly stating that his host was fighting a losing battle regardless of Malady's intervention. Bear in mind that this was a stronger version of base Celeste than the one shown 100 years ago who could fight with an early Dark Times Vader. Moving into the other half of the fight, Although it is true that Azalin's interference did bring a premature end to the Sith's force clash, full power Karnes Myrrh with his talisman and Celeste's body is confirmed to be more powerful than Vector Arc Krayt, meaning that he was likely still going to win the clash, even if only just. While his dueling skills are not well explored, Myrrh's power before his reawakening in the Dark Times is compared to figures like Mark Aragnos and Freedon Nadd, with his talisman being an additional power source confirmed to be one of the most dangerous dark side artifacts in history. With all of that considered, Darth Krayt, at his absolute weakest, was still strong enough to defeat Celeste Moore and push an amped Karnes Myrrh into going all out. Truly an incredible accomplishment that few could even attempt. Lastly, we have Darth Krayt's feats while at his peak. Having clawed his way back from the throes of death and rejuvenated his body with his new dark transfer ability, the Dragon of the Sith was reborn, far stronger than ever. During the first and final issues of Legacy War, Prime Krayt would engage Darth Wearlock and Cade Skywalker, both fights being testaments to his monstrous evolution. Starting with the Wearlock fight, Darth Krayt outclassed the Sith Lore Master at every turn, dispelling his lightning and TK attacks, and forcing him into an immediate backpedal when the contest switched to their lightsabers. Although Wearlock did appear at first to have humbled his former master when he attacked him with his magic, this was quickly revealed to have been a ploy from Krayt just to demonstrate how screwed Wearlock truly was, and he was killed instantly. As noted by many sources, Darth Wearlock was the second strongest Dark Lord of the entire One Sith Order, having previously stomped a rejuvenated Darth Andedu, an ancient Sith whose weaker holocron form could give even Darth Bane some resistance. Despite such accolades and feats, Darth Krayt outfought Darth Wearlock without using anything close to his full strength, proving without a shadow of a doubt who the true Emperor was. Moving into Darth Krayt's battle with Cade Skywalker, we have a contest that was closer and ultimately ended in the Emperor's final death, though not without reason. The fight began with Krayt easily tossing Skywalker around with the Force while continuing his routine of informing his foe just how screwed they were. After a cut, we see that the duel had moved outside with both fighters now clashing sabers. Krayt continued to taunt Cade, telling him that it was because of his dark transfer that he had returned, stating that Cade had shown him what the power was, while Myrrh had revealed how to conjure it. The Sith then overpowered Cade and used his own ability against him, forcing Skywalker to undergo an agonizing process of death and rebirth. His spirit teetering on the edge of oblivion, Cade bore witness to Krayt's dark vision for the future, which included him becoming the Emperor's slave, and eventually his new host body. When Darth Krayt concluded his speech, he stood, fully believing that Cade had fallen to the dark side, and proclaimed him his apprentice. Returned from death, Cade rose and said that he saw his place in the galaxy and understood who he was. Then, in a flash, Cade summoned his father's saber and plunged the blade into the unsuspecting Sith Lord's chest, stating that he was a Jedi and that Krayt was not his master. Knowing full well of Dark Transfer's regenerative properties, Cade gathered the Emperor's corpse and flew it into Coruscant's sun to ensure that every last atom was annihilated. Finally, after over a century of terrifying the universe, Darth Krayt was finally dead. Now, while Krayt did die at the end of his final battle with Cade Skywalker, he didn't really lose either, at least not in the sense of being directly bested through superior skill or strength. Cade was putting up a fight, no question, but Krayt was holding the edge nearly the entire time and directly overpowered Skywalker both physically and with his dark transfer. It is only through a combination of Krayt's arrogance and Cade's use of trickery that the Jedi wins, and even then, the only reason the Sith doesn't regenerate is due to being thrown into the sun. Not only that, but the story makes it pretty clear that Darth Krayt was making an effort to keep Cade partially alive in order to turn him to the dark side of the Force, much like Darth Vader's first battle with Luke Skywalker on Bespin. Overall, this fight may have cost Krayt his life and certainly exposed the flaws in his mindset, but purely from a standpoint of skill and strength, he still comes out looking rather impressive. Cade was a hurdle for the Emperor, but not one that required his full strength. He believed that the Crusader's true potential lay elsewhere, a miscalculation that ultimately led to his downfall. However, had they been going all out, it's pretty clear that Krayt would have emerged victorious. He did overpower Cade both physically and through the Force, after all. This is particularly noteworthy considering that by the end of Legacy, Cade Skywalker had become strong enough to dismiss top tier 1 Sith like Darth Talon and just put up a significantly better fight against Krayt than Wirlock. Moving into technique and attributes, Darth Krayt was a well and true Sith warrior, who possessed a dynamic skill set that was cultivated through many decades of training and battles with several of Star Wars' strongest characters. As noted by many sources, Krayt aided in the training of every single member of the One Sith, suggesting at least a technical knowledge of all 7 forms of classical lightsaber combat, though his primary martial arts specialization was Nyman. As specified by the Jedi Path, Nyman's moveset revolved around balance, drawing on elements from all 5 previous styles to create a hybrid form marked for its practicality. The art did not do any one thing perfectly, but it also did a little bit of everything, making it arguably the most well-rounded of the core saber forms. In addition to its technical versatility, Nyman was the combat style directly associated with using twin blades, aka the Jarkai method, as well as integrating force powers into one's combat sequences. Due to Nyman's emphasis on moderation, the form was highly effective at defeating large groups, with the Jarkai technique being a noted counter to more exotic weapon types such as staffs or whips. That being said, Form 6's comparatively relaxed focus on blade work made it ill-suited to engage dueling-centric styles such as Makashi, and left practitioners somewhat lacking in the power department. Shifting into his actual means of battle, Darth Krayt's offensive technique was both calculated and extremely vicious. In accordance with his philosophy of control, Krayt will utilize whatever style, weapon, or tactic he deems necessary to crush his foes beneath his heel. Though he reveled in his saber work, he had zero hesitancy obliterating foes with his force powers, shooting them dead with a blaster, or even just ripping them apart with his bare hands. In regards to his attack patterns, Krayt's offensive sequences have been frequently depicted as very physical, utilizing sweeping slashes, pivoting cuts, and pinpoint double stabs, all while continuously shifting his stance and grip to keep his opponents off balance and dissect their defenses. He has also been shown employing a clearly Dejem So-inspired attack pattern consisting of heavy-handed power strikes, though this only came out whenever he opted for a single lightsaber, which was rare. Regarding alternative training, Krayt is a confirmed master of the hand-to-hand fighting style Teras Kaze, which he frequently integrated into his saber sequences, appearing to favor flying kicks, palm strikes, and wrist locks. Rather expectantly for a Nyman master, the Emperor was also extremely skilled at pairing off his physical skills with his force powers, with telekinesis, lightning, dark transfer, and telepathy as his mains. While Darth Krayt's Vong disease meant that his strength fluctuated throughout his life, it also forced him to keep his defensive skills sharp lest he be overthrown. Given his core style's effectiveness at controlling the battlefield, Krayt rarely had problems intercepting projectiles or guarding against attacks from multiple flanks, such as when he single-handedly slaughtered an entire squad of Imperial Knights. When engaged in one-on-one battle, he relied on Jarkai X-blocks to cancel out a fighter's forward momentum, as well as binding techniques to tie up their weapons and leave them open to counters. Although the Dark Lord wasn't one for acrobatics, he was more than willing to employ subtle shifts of his stance to dodge incoming strikes whenever necessary. Shifting into strategic prowess, Emperor Krayt was an oddity amongst the Order of the Sith Lords, existing as a hybridization of previous eras and something entirely new. Unlike the majority of his forebears, Krayt was devoted to establishing a lasting order and peace by any means necessary. This corrupted version of peace was one where he held total domination over everything, as he genuinely believed that the universe needed his iron hand to survive the never-ending wars that intelligent life seemed to produce. Although his ideals were ultimately twisted by his crippling fear of death, after his rebirth, Krayt no longer dreaded oblivion, but instead saw it as a passageway to something greater. This mindset resulted in battle tactics centered around control and adaptation. Like Palpatine, Krayt was a frequent user of Dune Moak strategies, intimidating his foes by informing them of their inadequacies compared to himself, while provoking anger and confusion through targeted manipulation. That being said, he was also more than willing to play the subtle game of remaining silent, letting his actions speak for themselves. Krayt's secondary combat strategy was very much a combination of the methods employed by, well, Palpatine, but also Exar Kun. Like Palpatine, Krayt used his vast knowledge base to adapt to the fighting styles of his foes, while also supplementing these adaptations with sudden style changes like Exar in order to keep his enemies from adapting to him. While complementary, this extremely technical focus meant that he constantly had to maintain mental focus in order to adjust as needed. Speaking of mental attributes, while Darth Krayt did adhere to a warrior code of honor, like any Sith, he was willing to cheat if he started losing. Furthermore, while his tenacity could move galaxies, his arrogance was easily his biggest shortcoming. Darth Krayt has let his guard down prematurely on several occasions, resulting in dire consequences, the most obvious example being his death at Cade's hands. Although this is unconfirmed, I believe this arrogance was also influenced by the Emperor's post-rebirth belief system and the properties of his dark transfer. Basically, since he no longer fears death and can regenerate, he thinks he can do whatever he wants in a fight, even if he would not normally do so. That said, I also recognize that many of his lapses, especially the one with Cade, had other circumstances at play, making it more of an occasional weakness rather than a constant. Despite the irrefutable fact that these emperors are two of the strongest and most skilled fighters of the entire Star Wars license, this conclusion is shockingly straightforward regarding how its disparate elements stack up. As mentioned, Darth Sidious saw physical combat as a means to an end, whereas Krayt viewed it as a fundamental facet of life. While a divergence in mentality does not necessitate a divergence in aptitude, this dynamic is a rather appropriate summation of the Dark Lord's strengths. To put it simply, Darth Krayt has comparable martial knowledge, a more varied fighting style, higher scaling, and more impressive combat feats to his name than Darth Sidious. Starting with the technicals of their fighting styles, both emperors are credited directly or indirectly with mastery of virtually every mainline Jedi and Sith lightsaber form and various other alternative disciplines. However, whereas Palpatine's style was focused on linearly tearing his targets apart with blindingly fast staccatos, Krayt's style was more about destabilizing his targets through continuously changing attack patterns. Both can, and have, walked in each other's shoes, but when it comes to their consistently demonstrated methods, Krayt's style just gives him more to work with. His use of Jar-Kai offers him more vectors of attack, with his defenses being shown to be more reliable when faced with comparable opposition. Both Sith are also highly skilled at integrating their physical and force skills with their saber sequences, so that cancels out. Tactically speaking, Sidious and Krayt were the central villains of their respective eras and are renowned for their intelligence, cunningness, and perseverance. Although I suppose one could make the case for Palpatine being the superior grand schemer due to what he pulled off, Krayt's instincts are way more developed when it comes to battle intelligence. Both are arrogant, and both have let their guards down when they realistically shouldn't have, but not only has Krayt demonstrated more variance in his strategies than Sidious, but he has also showcased a greater consistency at keeping his cool in the face of resistance. That isn't to say that Krayt can't be thrown off his mental game, as shown when Cade taunted him into a frenzy at the climax of Volume 3, but that was a scenario where the Jedi was explicitly directing his taunts towards the Sith Lord's illness, which wouldn't be a factor in this matchup. Moving into Feats, the primary substantiations for Darth Krayt being above Darth Sidious as a martial artist are his fight performances against Ben Kenobi and Abeloth, as well as his scaling compared to Prime Luke Skywalker. Even if we assume that Kenobi's improvement between ROTS and the Tatooine duel was minimal, it does not change the fact that Head clashed with a top tier of the prequel era before even becoming a Sith. Yes, he did lose, and there were some environmental elements at play. However, Kenobi still acknowledged Head's skills and had to get serious to end the fight. The fact that Asherad wasn't instantly stomped by Ben really showcases just how monstrous the future Emperor's martial potential truly was. It is also worth stating that Asherad could potentially qualify for the same Dark Times training accolade given to Kenobi, depending on if you still consider him a Jedi, which, when combined with the years he spent fighting as a warlord, goes a long way towards justifying his performance. Jumping to the Abeloth fight, this is where Darth Krayt's standing becomes the most apparent. Contrary to what some would argue, for whatever reason, Abeloth did not hold back against Krayt and Luke during their battle in Beyond Shadows, nor was either combatant incapable of harming the diminished Chaos Bringer on a one-to-one basis. In fact, it happens several times. As I said in his breakdown, even if Abeloth was only operating at 10% or less of her usual strength, FOTJ Krayt was still skilled enough to injure an entity whose peak rivaled the ones of Mortis, and was stated to be the equivalent of 12 Luke Skywalkers, which segues nicely into our final point of scaling. Although Sidious and Luke were very close as swordsmen, like his master Yoda before him, Luke ultimately proved himself to be the Emperor's superior. There is some ambiguity as to whether or not Leia amped Luke with the totality of her strength or just unlocked more of his latent potential, but it's not really a big issue in the grand scheme of things. Luke is stated to be stronger than ever in the novel Jedi Search, which takes place just 1 year after Dark Empire, which would logically include his hypothetical Leia amped self. The Jedi Master would go on to attain multiple new peaks of strength in the ensuing decades, being repeatedly referred to as the most powerful Jedi in the galaxy, and building up his ragtag group of students into a fully functioning coalition of light side adepts. Luke's scaling above Sidious is further backed up by his victories over Supreme Overlord Shimra and the Sith Lord Darth Kytus, both of whom being confirmed to be stronger than Darth Sidious. Combine all of that with the 3 additional years of training and experience leading into the Fate of the Jedi books, and this is the version of Luke Skywalker that Darth Krayt is compared to. Even if we set aside Troy Denning's statements due to their vagueness, Krayt still definitively fought and inflicted damage to Abeloth at a similar rate to Luke, signifying that the two men are comparable and therefore scaling his feats accordingly. I award Darth Krayt the edge for martial arts skill and combative strategy. Despite believing himself to have transcended the standards of conventional morality, Darth Sidious was evil incarnate. Though born into one of Naboo's most esteemed royal houses, Palpatine was anything but an ordinary man, appearing to have sprung from nature itself. As a Lord of the Sith, Sidious was one of the greatest dark side adepts to have ever lived, being the culmination of 1,000 years of evolution and study. As rulership was his ambition, rulership became his main form of expression, and as a result, his powers were quick, subversive, and godlike in their magnitude. Having spent decades learning the deepest secrets the Force has to offer, Palpatine's expansive skill set made him a terrifying opponent to face in combat. Starting with his pure strength in the Force, Sidious is stated numerous times to have been the most powerful Sith in all of galactic history by the time of Revenge of the Sith, even receiving a power enhancement by the dark energies of Order 66 and Anakin's corruption into Darth Vader. These accolades would logically place the Emperor above characters such as the legendary Darth Bane, who is stated to have garnered greater knowledge and power than any of the pre-Rule of Two Sith, Darth Plagueis, who is confirmed to have been the previous peak of the Rule of Two until he was killed by his apprentice during the Phantom Menace, and Darth Tyrannus, whose power rivaled the likes of Mace Windu and Yoda. Speaking of the Jedi Grandmaster, Episode 3 Yoda and Episode 3 Sidious are consistently portrayed as being very close in terms of power levels, with some sources referring to them as direct equals while others attribute Sidious with a slight edge. Moving into the post-prequel timeframe, Palpatine's power in the dark side of the Force would become even greater, spending over two decades pushing the boundaries of Sith teachings in an effort to preserve his control over the Empire and discover the secrets of immortality. While his exact rate of growth is difficult to gauge since he doesn't take part in many fights, we can get a decent summation of the OT Emperor's power level through his scaling to Darth Vader. As I've said many times in this video, Vader was able to surpass the power of Episode 3 Anakin very early into the Dark Times. The Dreadlord would go on to reach multiple new peaks of power leading up to and during the events of the original trilogy until finally arriving at Return of the Jedi, where he is stated to be more powerful than ever, minus the conflict he experienced when fighting his son. Despite Darth Vader's monstrous levels of improvement, Darth Sidious was still consistently referred to as his superior, with George Lucas stating in an interview with Rolling Stone magazine that Episode 6 Vader was 80% as powerful as Episode 6 Sidious, hence his desire to recruit Luke to his side. After Palpatine's original body was destroyed by Anakin Skywalker aboard the second Death Star, the Emperor's essence would make its way to his secret base on Biss, where he would reincarnate into a clone body. Over the next 6 years, Sidious would build back the resources of his empire while also training his Force abilities like never before. By the time of Dark Empire 1, Sidious's power had ascended far beyond anything he had ever achieved in the past, so much so that his form could no longer support it. It is no exaggeration to say that he had become as close to a true Force entity as any mortal Darksider had ever attained, existing primarily as a being of formless energy rather than flesh. In terms of direct power scaling, Luke Skywalker is stated to have been weaker than ancient clone body Sidious as of Dark Empire Issue 2, despite his status as a Jedi of the highest order and the illusions made between him and his father. Luke would go on to become immensely more powerful under Sidious's tutelage, even as his mind was being slowly dominated. The young Jedi would eventually become strong enough to force the Emperor into his immature clone body to beat him during their ferocious duel in the cloning lab. Darth Sidious would reach his peak of power during the final battle of Dark Empire 1 when his clone reached its mature form. In this state, he is noted by the Dark Empire sourcebook to possess seemingly boundless power, and was even called one of the most dangerous humans in all of galactic history. It was only thanks to Leia dispelling the Emperor's hold on Luke's mind and unlocking more of his infinite force potential that the Jedi Master was finally able to surpass Sidious's power. This brush with darkness and reawakening in the light would, ironically, expand Luke Skywalker's understanding of the Force far beyond his previous expectations, enabling him to quickly surpass the strength of his Leia-amped self and guide his new Jedi Order into worlds unlike anything that had ever preceded them. Moving into his actual abilities, Palpatine, like many Sith of his caliber, was highly adept at utilizing both Curato Salva and Dark Rage techniques to enhance the performance level of his physical body, having a particular fondness for enhancements of speed sufficient to blitz powerful council masters, as well as match Grand Master tier adepts like Yoda and Dark Empire Luke. As far as telekinetic abilities went, Darth Sidious has been noted by a number of sources for his overwhelming power as well as his deadly skill, with his portrayals typically alternating between direct application of TK to pulverize foes into paste and subtle manipulations to play the field. His force blasts could crush buildings like they were puny toys and bury the famed Lasankia Superstar Destroyer, which has a confirmed length of 19,000 meters under the surface of Coruscant. While not explicitly shown, the Emperor has also mused that he could effortlessly destroy his office and crack the foundations of the gargantuan Imperial Palace. A TK feat well within the realms of believability given his scaling in the wider Star Wars universe. Seriously, this is like nothing compared to his peak. Two of Palpatine's most frequently used TK techniques for one-on-one battle were Force Throw and Force Pull, the most well-known examples being when he hurled multiple Senate pods at Yoda while simultaneously levitating others to be used as platforms. That being said, the Emperor did not require external objects to gain the high ground, as he was also a master of Force Flight, which enabled him to levitate himself off the ground and maneuver through the air for a prolonged period. This technique was typically used in conjunction with Force Maelstrom, which we'll cover later. Getting more sadistic, Sidious was highly adept in the use of the iconic Force Choke ability, allowing him to conjure an invisible hand around a being's windpipe to throttle them to death, such as when he killed two Mandalorians without even looking at them. In regards to his ability to overpower the telekinetic defenses of other adepts, Sidious could honestly be said to surpass 75% of the franchise. He nearly succeeded in blasting away Mace Windu when he was not using Vapad and exchanged piercing blasts with Yoda later on. The Sith Lord was also shown ragdolling Prime Galen Merrick in the dark side ending of TFU1, which, while not canon, is again very believable given the scaling of the two characters. As for telekinetic defense, Palpatine was very capable, but by no means invincible. While he had little issue deflecting objects thrown at him by Yoda or buffeting the attacks of an enraged Galen Merrick, his barriers could not completely negate the power of Dark Empire Luke Skywalker. Though, considering this is Luke we're talking about, I'd hardly call it unimpressive. Next up we have telepathic prowess, which I honestly believe could tie with energy manipulation for being Sidious's most advanced branch of power. Whereas most Force adepts use telepathy to subtly influence other beings, the Emperor's powers were much more akin to straight-up hypnosis. They have even been referred to as such. Not only could he easily dominate the minds of normal sentients and animals, but he was even capable of influencing the psyches of other trained Force wielders, which is consistently portrayed as an impressive accomplishment since they are all born with a degree of passive telepathic resistance. Taking things even further, Palpatine could glimpse the distant future through farsight, painfully rip information from a target with drained knowledge, and erase memories with memory rub, even being implied to have done so to thousands or millions of Imperials to safeguard the location of the Lysenkia. All that being said, he was more than capable of using mind manipulation in more subtle ways, frequently implanting dreams in the minds of enemies or his own subjects as a means of controlling them. He has also been credited with the ability to guard his mind from telepathic interference, with even the powerful Jedi Council Master Shaak Ti being incapable of reading his thoughts. Sidious's last and arguably most impressive telepathic power was a Sith variant of battle meditation. Hailed through the ages, battle meditation was a supreme-grade telepathic technique that enabled practitioners to enhance the morale, stamina, and overall combat effectiveness of their allies while simultaneously reducing the strength of their foes by eroding their wills to fight, with the dark side variant obviously placing a heavy emphasis on control. The Emperor's most famous use of battle meditation occurred during the historic Battle of Endor, with his will being the singular driving force behind the Imperial Navy's success, which ironically ended up being their downfall once he was killed. Unsurprisingly for a character with such versatile telepathy, Palpatine's sense branch-based abilities were also highly advanced. Like most adepts, he could extend his conscious mind outward to discern the presence, mood, and intentions of others, having described it as akin to an omnipresent mist, invisible but nonetheless tangible, that swirled and drifted constantly about him. However, certain perceptions, such as those with an inherent foundation in the light, could fall below his radar if they were pure enough. The Emperor is also strongly implied to be capable of seeing through basic force concealment abilities, though his upper limit is unknown. Speaking of concealment, Darth Sidious is famous for his ability to hide in plain sight, being able to stand at the center of the Jedi Council Chamber itself without the slightest betrayal of his true nature. However, it has been shown that the Sith Lord's veils could be breached if he was being actively sought out, though you'd have to be packing some pretty serious force power to make it happen. Although followers of the Sith were known to struggle when it came to mastering the healing arts, Sidious has been depicted using the Force to mend minor injuries, and even using the poison detoxification technique to hold off the effects of the AORTH6 necrotic virus unleashed on him by General Gentix. The Dark Lord's character sheet also credits him with mastery of hibernation trances, allowing him to slow his vital functions to a crawl in order to heal and conserve energy. Moving into the more esoteric branches of the Force, I think it's become pretty clear that Emperor Palpatine has a lot of powers under his belt, and we've only scratched the surface. His knowledge of the Sith and Jedi arts was so vast that some sources have speculated that he had mastered nearly all of the powers that were known during his lifetime, to the point where he could devise entirely new techniques at his leisure. His official credits include, but are not limited to, Force Corruption to saturate locations with darkness, Force Horror to drive people mad, Force Doppelganger to conjure hard light duplicates of himself or an object, Force Illusions to summon apparitions, Resist Stun to resist Force Stunning, Pyrokinesis to burn things, Enhance Force Sensitivity to empower his minions, and Force Drain to feed off the energies of a target to amp himself. His unofficial credits, i.e. powers that he is implied to know but has never actually demonstrated in any appreciable ways, include the Death Field, Mind Shards, Force Inertia, Force Blind, the Cruciform ability, Cryokinesis, Convection, and Combustion. It is also confirmed that he is aware of the Shatterpoint ability, though, once again, he has never demonstrated any manifestations comparable to characters such as Mace Windu or Cade Skywalker. That last point sums up a significant factor in this analysis. Palpatine may have working knowledge of nearly every force power under the binary suns, but knowing something does not necessarily equate to combative viability. Since many of the techniques he is officially credited with have only shown up sparingly, with the indirectly credited powers not having any feats to draw on, it's quite difficult to judge where his skill levels lie. I'm not saying that these abilities should be discounted, it's more a case of us literally having no idea how effectively the Emperor can use them in a battle, which opens up many possibilities. Cycling back to concrete powers, while Sidious himself states that he never advanced his practice of midichlorian manipulation to the same level as his master Plagueis, i.e. stopping death, it is confirmed that he can use it to prolong injuries that would result in death, as he did with Vader after rescuing him from Mustafar. On a similar note, Sidious spent many years studying the realm of Sith magic. However, his most notable uses were either for utility purposes, such as nullifying exotic poisons, or for grand-scale manipulations, such as conjuring a dream world to mess with Yoda. However, given that Count Dooku was a master of the Hoyaka spell, which allowed him to raise and control a horde of zombies, and we know that his initial tutoring in magic came directly from Sidious, I think it's reasonable to assume that he too could employ this strategy if needed. The Emperor's most notable power during the Dark Empire storyline was Essence Transfer, which he uncovered at some point in the Dark Times after torturing a Jedi archivist. Also known as Transfer Life, Essence Transfer was an extremely advanced dark side power that involved transferring a user's ethereal energies into another vessel. Although being able to manifest as a Sith spirit is not stated to be a prerequisite for using Essence Transfer, the two do seem to be closely connected, which makes sense. As far as technicals go, Essence Transfer was essentially a Darksider's last resort, as the use of the power always resulted in the practitioner's original body being destroyed. Their minds would then have to overcome the psyches of the body they wish to inhabit, lest they have their spirit thrown into the void. That last risk could be overcome by transferring into either an inanimate object or a mindless clone. However, both had the drawbacks of immovability and accelerated aging. Despite Sidious originally needing to build back his strength after every transfer, his skills with the technique eventually advanced to where he could recover his powers much faster, essentially granting him an auto-respawn whenever in proximity to his clones. That said, he was still susceptible to the risk of losing himself to chaos if he failed to overcome the spirit of an unwilling vessel, a risk that ultimately resulted in his total destruction. Last but certainly not least, we have Darth Sidious's capabilities in the realm of energy manipulation. He is the first character introduced in the Star Wars franchise to conjure Force Lightning, and is, without question, the poster Sith for the ability. In terms of potency, Palpatine's blue or purple lightning was powerful enough to instantly knock out or kill targets upon contact, sometimes even reducing them to skeletons or smoldering piles of ash. During their battle in the Senate arena, it was shown in every mainline version of ROTS that Yoda deflecting Sidious's Force Lightning was an extremely taxing endeavor for him. Decades later, Anakin Skywalker would take fatal damage from the Emperor's lightning despite him having endured a massive barrage from an amped Starkiller in TFU2. Dark Empire Luke Skywalker was later knocked back by one of Sidious's electrical attacks, despite him having just had his mind freed by Leia. All of these feats confirm that the Emperor could threaten a very large percentage of the Star Wars universe with the ability, given the scaling of his victims. In terms of variation, Palpatine was capable of chaining bolts of Force Lightning through multiple targets simultaneously, and could conjure static barriers to protect himself. Getting a bit more technical, we have the Emperor's mastery of the Force Maelstrom technique. Also known as Force Bombard, Maelstrom was a hybrid power that combined lightning, the static barrier, and TK. Practitioners would seal themselves inside a force bubble while simultaneously lifting loose objects around them and then charging said objects with lightning, transforming them into deadly projectiles. As mentioned, Sidious often used Force Maelstrom in conjunction with Force Flight as a means of gaining the high ground and quite literally raining down destruction upon his foes. However, maintaining such a powerful ability was not something he could do indefinitely, often requiring short respites between uses. On the defensive side of energy manipulation, Sidious is a confirmed practitioner of the Tutaminus ability, being able to dispel Galen Merrick's lightning and likely much more powerful applications as well. He was also a user of weather manipulation, occasionally summoning wind, rain, or fracturing the skies with conjured lightning to mask his presence. That being said, such alterations were not always a conscious effort, as he was just so mind-bogglingly evil that the weather would change in response to his presence. Finally, we come to Darth Sidious's ultimate power in the realm of energy, that being the Force Storm. Confirmed as one of the strongest manifestations of the dark side, period, Force Storms were essentially chaos personified. By surrendering oneself fully to the chaotic energies that swirl invisibly around all things, practitioners could conjure wormholes in hyperspace that manifested as swirling vortexes of pure energy directed by their will. In terms of destructive potential, while Force Storms were known to consume fleets of ships and destroy entire worlds, that was far from their limit. As hyperspace is a realm stated to exceed both the third spatial and fourth temporal dimensions, this would mean that Force Storms have the potential to unleash levels of energy far in excess of an entire universe if left unchecked. In regards to usage, Sidious has three separate feats pertaining to the use of Force Storms. The first took place in DE Issue 1, wherein an ancient clone body Sidious sent forth a storm which devastated a portion of Coruscant and transported Luke many light years away to Biss. The second feat took place off-screen, yet it is referenced in the audio drama that Sidious conjured multiple storms in different star systems at the same time as the one he sent to Coruscant, which caused drastic effects on the New Republic fleet. The final feat took place at the climax of the volume, which showcased peak Sidious conjuring a Force Storm far more powerful than any he had used before in a final desperate attempt to destroy his enemies once and for all. While this storm was stated to have had the potential to not only destroy the New Republic, but threaten the entirety of space itself, such power was nothing compared to the Jedi United, with Luke and Leia severing the Emperor's power and turning his own wormhole against him. Now, as utterly insane as those feats may have been, Sidious's storms were not without their numerous drawbacks. The first hurdle was the learning curve. Due to both their power requirement and complexity, few adepts could so much as attempt to conjure a wormhole, let alone control one, with Palpatine requiring multiple decades of training just to reach a level of viable usage. Even then, he still required some charge-up time before unleashing it. The second hurdle was the area of effect. While the potential destructive output of a Force Storm was borderline unlimited, it was, by its very nature, a large-scale attack. This meant that Sidious couldn't really get much use out of it in close quarters fights, since doing so would result in him being consumed by the vortex as well. The final hurdle revolved around the Emperor's control. While Sidious has clearly advanced his practice of Force Storms far beyond that of his forebears and has claimed to have perfected the power, the lore spins a slightly different narrative. He was not able to maintain control of the wormhole at the end of Volume 1. And while him being caught off guard by Luke and Leia's light side powers was a contributing factor, the official Dark Empire endnotes do state that the Emperor's claim of perfecting Force Storms was just a load of BS. This would mean that while he could theoretically summon multidimensional calamities, his ability to tame them was relatively limited. Which makes sense since you can't really control chaos itself. Darth Krayt was the legendary Dragon of the Sith who, despite believing his actions to be for the greater good of the universe, existed as the dark half of the Throne of Balance, a metaphysical realm within the Force that represented the primordial conflict between good and evil. If Sidious was the ultimate example of a man born into the dark side, then Krayt was the ultimate example of a man forged by the dark side. Having begun his life as a disciple of the light before tragedy and a lust for vengeance twisted him into an agent of evil. As a Jedi Master, Asherad Het was an extraordinarily accomplished Force adept, whose potential was noted to exceed that of his father, Sherad Het, one of the most famous and respected figures in the history of the old Jedi Order. As a Lord of the Sith, Darth Krayt was one of the darkest emperors to have ever ruled the galaxy, having journeyed through the fires of death itself and come back stronger. Since total control was his ambition, control became the basis of his philosophy, with his Force powers being quick, domineering, and otherworldly in scale. Having spent over 100 years plundering the holocrons of the ancient Sith and exploring the astral planes, Krayt boasted an expansive skill set that made him one of the most dangerous beings in existence. Starting with his pure strength in the Force, Asherad Het was noted on numerous occasions before and during the Clone Wars to possess incredible power, with his father fully believing that his son would eventually surpass him. For reference, Asherad Het is confirmed to be a council-level fighter whose power was commended by Qui-Gon Jinn, a Jedi Master who was capable of holding his own against Phantom Menace Darth Maul. As surprising as it may sound, there are actual sources that imply TPM Maul to be more powerful than Darth Bane, who himself is confirmed to surpass the pre-Rule of Two Sith. Moving into the post-prequel timeframe, Asherad Het would survive the calamity of Order 66 and make his way to Tatooine, where he established rule over a number of Tusken tribes. As I mentioned previously, while it is debatable whether or not Het could qualify for the same Dark Times power accolade given to Jedi such as Ben Kenobi, since his actions as a warlord were rather un-Jedi-like, he is confirmed to have been actively preparing for his own war against the Empire, so it is indisputable that he became stronger. This accolade is corroborated by the fact that Het's dark presence in the Force was impressive enough to make Kenobi kind of antsy, which isn't unimpressive given his scaling. After his loss to Ben and subsequent exile from his people, Het would eventually end up on the planet Korriban, where he discovered the holocron and ghost of Zozon, one of the first Sith to have ever existed. Although the specifics of Asherad's training under his new master are largely unexplored, he is confirmed by the Complete Encyclopedia to have gained a great deal of strength in the Force, so much so that he believed he could take the fight directly to Vader and Palpatine after he emerged. Unfortunately, Het soon found out that he was a little late to the party and decided to fling himself into the unknown regions, where he was then captured and experimented on by the Yuuzhan Vong and the renegade Sith Verger. This would end up being a bit of a dark blessing, as the Vong's horrific torture combined with Verger's teachings allowed Asherad to embrace the darkness in its totality and complete his transformation into Darth Krayt, making him far more powerful than before. Though not confirmed, one could make the argument that Krayt's degree of power enhancement was similar to what we witnessed from Jason Solo in the novel Traitor, given the parallels in their experiences. After escaping the Vong and returning to Korriban, Krayt would begin building his One Sith Order while strengthening his own dark side capabilities by way of training and exploring the astral plane during periods of stasis. By the time of the Fate of the Jedi series, Darth Krayt had become powerful enough to where he existed as Luke Skywalker's dark side match on the Throne of Balance. Although this accolade could be interpreted as Krayt being Luke's equivalent in terms of cosmological influence rather than Force power, he still fought relative to Luke against Abeloth, with the Grand Master being unsettled by the Sith Lord's aura upon first meeting. The Essential Reader's Companion adds further credence to this scaling by stating point blank that Luke recognized Krayt as a powerful Sith, meaning that they were comparable. To say that this is impressive would be a gargantuan understatement, considering the monstrous power gains Luke Skywalker had made by that point in the story, surpassing the past versions of himself by a considerable margin. Following Aboloth's defeat, Darth Krayt's power level would fluctuate wildly in the years leading up to and during the events of the Legacy comics. Despite still being noted as one of the most powerful Dark Lords in all of history, surpassing every member of the One Sith, age and disease would cause the Emperor's strength to steadily dwindle between Volumes 1 and 6. By the time of the Vector arc, Krayt's dark side power had diminished so severely that he was weaker than the ghost of Karnas Myrrh while he was in possession of his talisman and the body of Celeste Morn. That being said, Karnas would, ironically, end up becoming one of the main catalysts for Darth Krayt's rebirth in Volume 11, having inadvertently shown the Dragon of the Sith how to use Dark Transfer, as well as advance his practice of essence manipulation. With this newfound knowledge, Krayt clawed his way back from the Valley of Death and healed his flesh of the Vong infestation, transforming him into a creature of pure destruction. Now, while there has been some debate as to whether or not Darth Krayt's rebirth made him more powerful than ever, or had instead rewound him back to the level he displayed against Aboloth, I think the answer is actually a bit of both. Numerous sources, along with Krayt himself, have described his new form as being multitudes beyond what he was in the previous Legacy volumes, with series illustrator and co-writer Jan Dursama stating that the reborn Emperor understood his powers better than he ever had before. This makes sense considering how the story is presented. Krayt healing himself would logically allow him to regain the strength he had lost, but we mustn't forget that he also has many additional decades of combat experience under his belt, along with a plethora of new force abilities. As such, even if there was relatively little change in Darth Krayt's raw power level between Fate of the Jedi and Legacy War, which might not even be the case, he would still be significantly more lethal than his past self due to the gains made in experience, understanding, and his moveset. Shifting into his actual abilities, Darth Krayt, much like Sidious, was an exemplar when it came to utilizing Curato Salva and Dark Rage to boost the performance of his physical body, often favoring enhancements of strength that were sufficient to dominate powerful Jedi like Cade Skywalker, and even puncture the chest of celestial tier beings like Aboloth. In the realm of telekinesis, Darth Krayt's skill level is stated by Insider Issue 88 to have far outstripped those of any other Sith of his era, even when he was still sick. This would mean that any telekinetic feat or technique demonstrated by a member of the One Sith Order can be scaled to Darth Krayt, even if the Emperor has never shown them himself. Such feats would include Darth Red partially manipulating a starship-sized chunk of wreckage, as well as techniques like the Force Wound exhibited by Darth Talon, the Energy Barrier exhibited by Darth Azard, and the Force Flight exhibited by Lomi Plo. In regards to direct showings, Krayt could disintegrate solid stone with a flick of his wrist, and he has even conjured force blasts powerful enough to inflict lasting damage to a weakened Aboloth. Such TK blasts were also portrayed as having a similar level of impact on the Chaosbringer as the ones thrown at her by Luke Skywalker, so they clearly packed a godly punch. When it comes to one-on-one battles, Krayt's most frequently utilized TK moves were Force Pull, Force Deflection, and Force Throw. Notable examples being when he yanked Aboloth to him by pulling the severed hand lodged in her chest towards its stump, and later redirected a volley of boulders thrown at him by Darth Wearlock. The Emperor was also rather skilled at utilizing the Force Choke for quick kills or incapacitations, even successfully using it against adepts as strong as Darth Nihil. Unsurprisingly for such a powerful Darksider, Darth Krayt was highly effective when it came to overpowering the Force defenses of other adepts. He has manhandled disobedient Sith underlings like they were nothing, and consistently ragdolled Cade Skywalker despite the Crusader becoming significantly more powerful over the course of the comic. The Emperor was likewise depicted piercing a weakened Abalos Force defenses sufficiently to inflict tangible damage to the Chaosbringer, which, quite frankly, is one of the most impressive TK feats in the verse. By that same token, Krayt was able to resist one of Abaloth's Force Blasts despite being shot at point-blank range, which showcases a magnitude of Force defense that precious few could even fathom. In keeping with his emphasis on control, Darth Krayt was supremely skilled in the field of mental manipulation. Like Sidious, Krayt's telepathic powers were portrayed as more hypnotism than suggestion, completely dominating the minds of sentients and animals, even maintaining a passive presence within the minds of some of his followers, lest any of them forget who is in charge. While passively influencing the psyches of other Force users is impressive on its own, Krayt could also take a more active approach, on one occasion telepathically communicating with Luke Skywalker without the latter's consent before their fight with Abaloth. In terms of grand-scale telepathic manipulation, the Emperor would showcase one of his most famous feats in Legacy Issue 50, wherein he sent ripples through the Force to make his presence known to every single being who served the dark side. Though unconfirmed, given how the text states that every Sith save Wirlock was invigorated by their master's return, one could argue that Darth Krayt might have actually been using a form of the Enhanced Force Sensitivity power to systematically amp the entirety of the One Sith Order. Which, even just speculating that makes me go cross-eyed. The comic also introduced Krayt's mastery of the Force Bond power, forging a mental link between himself and his Sith troopers in order for them to act as pure extensions of his will. This bond was so all-encompassing that the troopers were driven into insanity upon their master's death. Moving into smaller-scale mental powers, Darth Krayt was able to see into the future with farsight, affect dreams, is noted by Talon to be capable of ripping information from a target, implying a mastery of drain knowledge, and is officially credited by his character sheet with both battle mind and fear effects resistance, the latter of which being displayed in his fight with Wirlock. Krayt's final and most unique telepathic ability was mind walking. An ancient power developed by the Mindwalkers of Sinkhole Station, mindwalking allowed users to separate their minds and spirits from their physical bodies by way of focused meditation. While in this state, practitioners could journey through various Force planes, most frequently the Realm Beyond Shadows, which is how Krayt was able to appear before Luke to battle Abaloth. Moving into the Sense branch, Darth Krayt's awareness and ability to perceive through the Force has consistently been portrayed to be extremely acute. Even when he was sick, he had no issues feeling the presence or states of mind of those around him, nor did he struggle when it came to perceiving immediate or long-term intent. There is also considerable implication that the Emperor is capable of seeing through Force concealment powers, as several sources have made note of how borderline impossible it was to get the drop on him. Keeping with the theme of concealment for the moment, after Krayt was betrayed by Wirlock at the end of Vector, he drove his essence so deeply into himself that he appeared to have vanished from the Force entirely. This feat is virtually identical to the description of the Art of Small Power, which makes sense given that Vergère was one of the Dark Lord's teachers. Shifting into the realm of the arcane, Darth Krayt spent generations devouring every scrap of Force mythos that he could get his hands on. With his knowledge of Sith lore, rituals, and history being noted to have been rivaled only by his Wirlocks. As such, while Krayt's exact threshold when it came to dark side magics is unclear, he was obviously very proficient, having resisted Wearlock III's attempts to dominate him and later conjuring illusions powerful enough to rattle Cade Skywalker. In regards to spirit manipulation, the Emperor was highly adept with the aforementioned essence transfer ability, as well as consume essence to passively feed on the negative emotions of others to empower himself. Krayt could also take a more direct approach with his use of Force Drain, his prowess with the ability being sufficient to not just affect Luke Skywalker, but successfully siphon energy from Abeloth as well. During his time held captive by the Vong, Krayt built up a tolerance to physical pain well beyond the norm, while also learning how to use his agony as a source of power, which all but guarantees that he manifested an application of Crucitorn, ironically the signature force power of his father's master, Eeth Koth. Next up, we have Krayt's aptitude with Force Healing, Force Lightning, and the Shatterpoint ability, all of which coalesce into his ultimate power, that being Dark Transfer. Prior to his fall, Asherad Het was a highly proficient Jedi healer, having taken up a leadership position at a New Republic medical facility on New Holstus. While his natural aptitude was likely reduced following his Sith transformation, Darth Krayt obviously did not lose the years of healing knowledge he had accumulated, being able to enter hibernation trances with ease. After revealing his past identity to Cade Skywalker, the Emperor states that he had long since mastered Sith techniques for prolonging death. Whether or not this was a reference to midi-chlorian manipulation is unclear, but practicing any form of life extension is still indicative of incredible power. In the realm of Force Lightning, Krayt's skill level, just like his telekinesis, is stated by Insider 88 to far outstrip any other Sith of his era, even when he was sick. This would mean that any lightning feat or technique demonstrated by a member of the One Sith can be scaled to Darth Krayt, even if the Emperor has never shown them himself. Such techniques include the lightning chain exhibited by Darth Wearlock, and possibly the force net exhibited by Lomi Plo, if you consider it some sort of derivative of the force shock given its behavior. In terms of potency, Krayt's blue lightning was powerful enough to bypass the force immunity of Yuuzhan Vong to kill them, with Luke Skywalker instinctively readying himself to dodge when he suspected that the Sith Lord was conjuring an attack. This is far more significant a reaction than I think many realize. Not only does it confirm that Luke believed that Krayt's lightning would be a threat to him, which makes sense considering they had both just fought a fucking celestial, but Luke's intent to dodge could also be interpreted as him not being totally confident in his ability to dispel such an attack. Granted, it can also be seen as him being smart about his energy levels since they had both been weakened at the time and he knew that, but it's still a notable reaction regardless. In terms of variation, Darth Krayt was capable of surrounding someone in a veil of lightning so controlled that they weren't harmed, as well as fracturing the skies with the electrical storms that would sometimes change in relation to his mood. On the defensive front, Krayt possessed top-tier mastery of Tutaminus, having dispelled bolts of force lightning hurled at him by Darth Wearlock without any visible strain, indicating that his threshold with the power was extremely high. A pinnacle sense branch ability, Shatterpoint enabled Darth Krayt to perceive points of vulnerability, importance, or curiosity, the Dark Lord describing it as akin to seeing a network of fiery red lines at the core of existence that could be followed and manipulated. This principle was applicable both in direct combat with another being as well as the ability to literally shatter seemingly unbreakable objects with a single tap. That being said, it did still fall upon the user to interpret these shatter points within the bounds of what they were able or willing to comprehend. And as Krayt and others have demonstrated, it didn't make you omniscient. Finally, we come to Dark Transfer, Darth Krayt's most powerful force ability. Also known by the fan-coined name Shatterpoint Healing, Dark Transfer was an extraordinarily advanced hybrid technique that, as mentioned, combined elements of Force Healing, Force Lightning, and Shatterpoint. Though classified as a dark side power in the Legacy campaign guide, the ability was not exclusive to bad guys. As Cade Skywalker demonstrated at the end of the comic, not only could dark transfer be used in conjunction with the light side of the Force, but it actually worked better, producing higher levels of healing with a reduced stamina drain. Obviously, these parameters would not apply to Darth Krayt, seeing as he both gained and used dark transfer when he was a Sith, but that didn't mean his skills with it were underdeveloped. Quite the contrary, in fact. By combining Shatterpoint's metaphysical perceptions with Force Lightning's energy channeling and Force Healing's manipulation, a user of dark transfer could essentially pour the Force into someone or something's internal structure and repair it on a cellular level. Unlike the more common variants of Force Healing, which had very specific limitations in what they could mend, there didn't seem to be nearly as many constraints as to what mastered dark transfer could heal. Cranial trauma, lightsaber wounds, the fucking Rakagul plague, very little was off limits. Darth Krayt's most notable feat of healing with dark transfer was when he used it to finally rid himself of the Yorick coral seeds implanted into his body. An accomplishment that Volume 3 Cade initially wasn't sure was possible, and this was before the affliction had reached the stage it was at in Vector. Cade later states in Legacy War that Darth Krayt would eventually be able to regenerate from the killing stab inflicted to his chest. The young Jedi even questioning whether or not cutting off the Emperor's head would be enough to stop him, hence throwing his body into the sun. We never get full confirmation of these claims, but even if there was some exaggeration at play, the fact that Krayt's spirit and Cade even suggested these possibilities is pretty insane. That being said, just so we're abundantly clear, Krayt is not indestructible, nor can he straight up resurrect the dead. However, it has been shown that if someone still has a flicker of life within them, a skilled dark transfer user can bring them back, or at least keep them alive long enough for them to receive medical treatment. Obviously, these properties made the power quite viable when it came to defense, though defense was not its only possible usage. Dark transfer was very effective for offense if the users willingly dialed down the healing and ramped up the lightning and shattering. By overtaxing the areas where the shatter points intersected with an excess of energy, a practitioner could destroy either a person or object from the inside out. Such tactics could be applied both in direct manipulation or in exacerbation of injuries previously sustained. In terms of effectiveness, Krayt overpowered Cade Skywalker with offensive dark transfer during their final battle, with the comic making it clear that the Sith Lord could have torn the Jedi apart had he wished to. All insanity aside, Krayt's dark transfer is not the most powerful Force ability in the franchise, nor did it lack weaknesses. First off, the power's immense complexity required considerable Force energy to be maintained, making it rather taxing to a user's stamina. Although light side users could mitigate this weakness, that obviously isn't a factor that Krayt has going for him. Secondly, like most Force abilities, it is possible for a wielder of dark transfer to dispel the effects of another wielder of dark transfer if there is a gap in power or skill, something the Emperor has demonstrated. Finally, dark transfer could only be used if the practitioner was in direct physical contact with the target. Despite having elements of Force Lightning in its makeup, Krayt can't just conjure a bolt of dark transfer energy and chuck it at you. He needs to actually touch what he wants to mend or destroy in order to initiate the circuit, much like conventional Force healing abilities. Still though, as far as cost-to-benefit ratios go, there's certainly worse out there. Guys, this is a stomp. No, wait, come back, I'm sorry, I couldn't resist. Okay, stomp is a bit too definitive of a statement, but much like their martial arts training, Darth Sidious and Darth Krayt's dynamic as Force wielders is a fairly straightforward conclusion in terms of how everything stacks up. Again, there is no question that these two emperors are some of the greatest force wielders the Star Wars license has to offer, possessing knowledge and power that would bulldoze 90% of the competition. However, when set against each other, the lore doesn't really leave much room for debate beyond the technicals of how we imagine this confrontation would play out. Starting with just their power levels, the primary justification for Legacy War Krayt being above Dark Empire Sidious is his scaling to Fate of the Jedi Luke Skywalker and Abeloth. Even if we go with the interpretation of DE wherein Luke beat Palpatine thanks to Leia temporarily amping his powers with hers, it doesn't actually matter since Luke would go on to surpass that amped version of himself many times over. By the time of the Apocalypse novel, Luke's powers had grown to where he had defeated foes such as Darth Kytus, a Sith Lord with sources directly scaling him above Darth Sidious. Although Krayt's exact power compared to Luke is a bit vague, the two still recognized each other's cosmic importance, with their force attacks inflicting comparable damage to the same adversary. With that in mind, even if the two were not equals in every sense of the word, Darth Krayt and Luke Skywalker were definitely on par. And considering how Luke at this point had risen leagues above the version of himself that beat Sidious, it would simply be disingenuous to claim that the Dragon of the Sith was not also more powerful. Especially with the feat of wounding Abeloth, even an unbound Force Storm arguably doesn't compete with that. Some may point to Sidious's statements of being the most powerful Sith as a refutation to this scaling. However, we mustn't forget that these are referencing the Emperor as compared to every Sith that existed concurrently and before him. Darth Kytus, Darth Plagueis, and even Exar Kun all have material referring to them as the quote-unquote most powerful Sith ever. So clearly it's an incremental title as opposed to one encompassing the whole timeline. Raw power edge, Darth Krayt. Force techniques are similarly skewed, though with a heavier emphasis on how their mentalities influenced their development. Both emperors are obviously quite educated, having invested study into nearly every facet of Sith culture. Palpatine in particular boasts an absurdly vast arsenal of powers that grant him an almost unbounded range of functionality. Still, as I said before, versatility does not equate to viability. Darth Sidious may have a broader arsenal of abilities than Darth Krayt, but in terms of showcased effectiveness, Krayt's warrior mindset combined with his power makes him the more effective Sith Lord of the two. Curato Salva techniques coincide with physical capability, where we have already decided our verdict. In regards to telekinetic prowess, although Darth Sidious does have more large-scale manipulation feats to his name, considering Darth Krayt's scaling to characters like Kip Duron or Luke Skywalker, who have exceeded the Emperor's showings, it stands to reason that the Dragon of the Sith would follow suit. Regarding personal combat, Krayt's ability to bypass Abeloth's defenses sufficiently to damage her basically guarantees that he can do the same to Sidious, even despite her weakened state. Hell, you may not even need to go that far depending on where you scale Cade Skywalker in relation to Dark Empire Luke. Much the same dynamic is at play with the Sith's respective levels of TK defense due to Krayt's ability to resist Abeloth's force blasts at point-blank range. Telepathic capabilities are interesting. Sidious definitely has the edge in versatility, whereas Krayt takes the advantage in range, but the level of impact on this fight is pretty much a wash due to the Emperor's shared fear effects immunity. Both do have a history of altering the minds of Force adepts, however, almost none of those feats took place in active combat settings, with the few that did having either preemptive planning behind them or were situations where the target was noticeably weaker than the caster. Force drain and consume essence essentially cancel out, with sense, concealment, doppelganger, and enhanced sensitivity abilities having little to no relevance in a fight that takes place on neutral ground, so we won't bother comparing them. That said, to give credit where it's due, both emperors have displayed extremely advanced sensing, cloaking, and enhancement prowess, with Sidious's doppelganger technique speaking towards a higher range of deception skill than his competition. In regards to how Sith magic would come into play, I would say Krayt gets a tiny edge at best, with the category equaling out at worst. Despite being confirmed masters of the art, neither Emperor has been known to utilize offensive spells in combat, and since we're examining this match in a neutral setting, Sidious's ability to control the dead wouldn't come into play either. However, Krayt is the only one between the two who has been shown resisting the effects of magic in a fight, and that was against someone who literally specializes in magic, so there's that. Speaking of specializations, Darth Krayt holds a sizable advantage over Darth Sidious in the healing arts despite the dark side's natural shortcomings in the field. Even discounting the utter insanity of dark transfer, Krayt has been credited with many of the same powers attributed to Sidious and has made much more liberal use of his healing abilities both during and outside of battle. Although Palpatine does more than likely possess a better understanding of midichlorian manipulation than Krayt, assuming he even has it, I don't see it as enough to sway healing in Palpatine's favor due to the ambiguity surrounding his capabilities. On a similar note, Sidious transferring his essence into a new clone body does grant him a full HP respawn, however, this would, again, not be an applicable strategy in a neutral setting. Keeping with the topic of essence transfer for the moment, it's an ability that invites a host of possibilities for combative scenarios, and this one is no exception. Both emperors can use it, though how well they could do so against each other is debatable since we've never seen either overshadow the essence of another powerful force user. Yes, Darth Sidious threatened to merge with Luke, but he had been actively whittling down the Jedi Master's spirit at that time, and even then, he still tried to talk Luke into willingly accepting the merger. Darth Krayt made similar threats towards Cade, and while he did say that the Sith was slowly eating his mind, after Krayt's body was destroyed, he didn't possess Cade. Granted, Luke's spirit might have had something to do with that given the scene's dialogue, but that's just my theory. With that in mind, I believe the essence transfer debate comes down to matters of willpower and personal power. Sidious and Krayt possess godly levels of will, however, I can see Krayt's slightly better composure in the face of danger granting him a tiny mental advantage. Add this to his greater power level, which has been cited as a factor in an essence transfer struggle, and I once again have to side with Krayt in regards to spirit manipulation. Finally, we come to the pinnacle variable of this part of the verdict, which is Darth Sidious's and Darth Krayt's respective capabilities in the realm of energy manipulation. Now, it's difficult not to instinctually side with Palpatine regarding Force Lightning, as he is the most iconic user of the technique, and has displayed more versatility than Krayt in his applications. However, if we're being honest, Krayt's skills with lightning were not that far removed from Sidious's, having showcased both instantaneous conjuration and a broad range of usage. Add on potency, and Krayt's scaling, along with his implicit threats towards Luke Skywalker, basically confirms that he possesses a higher level of magnitude with the power than even Sidious. Also, because I know if I don't bring it up, someone will. No, purple lightning is not inherently more powerful than blue lightning. In fact, the notion of colors reflecting strength is a fan theory that has never actually been confirmed in lore. Colors are implied to reflect the user's spiritual makeup, but again, power is not a factor. On the defensive front, both Sith Lords can use Tutuminous to reduce the damage of their foes' energy attacks, with weather alternating abilities obviously being environmentally specific and therefore irrelevant. Lastly, we have their ultimate powers, Darth Sidious's Force Storms and Darth Krayt's Dark Transfer. I'm just gonna cut to the chase. When it comes to one-on-one combat, Dark Transfer is far superior to Force Storms, which ultimately tips the scales in the Dragon of the Sith's favor. Force Storms do have more destructive potential than Dark Transfer, but they are also harder to control, take considerably more time to summon, and pose just as much danger to the user as the target. Even if Palpatine was somehow able to keep Krayt at bay long enough to summon a storm and retain sufficient control to guide it towards the fight, he's just gonna end up being consumed by it as well. Assuming, of course, Krayt doesn't find a way to turn the energy back on Sidious like Luke and Leia did. While by no means bereft of weaknesses, Dark Transfer offers its users considerable defensive and offensive capabilities. Not only can Krayt mitigate the physical damage Sidious inflicts on him, but he can also attack his foe internally in ways the First Emperor has no way of countering. It's a power he probably doesn't even know exists. The technique's energy consumption is a notable factor, but it's not like Krayt has a low force energy reservoir to draw from. Even if he can't keep Dark Transfer going for long, it's not like he'll be totally drained after two uses. And even then, two well-placed uses may be all he'd need. Overall, when it comes to their capabilities as combative force wielders, the disparity between Darth Sidious and Darth Krayt is, well, just as consistent as it has been up until this point. Although the Sith Emperors are comparable in skill and speed, Krayt boasts a greater degree of raw power, comparable levels of wisdom, and techniques that provide him with special advantages in this match. Add on the Dragon of the Sith's physical and martial arts advantages, and, well, the rest is history. The battle between Darth Sidious and Darth Krayt would play out like a combination of Sidious's second battle with Luke Skywalker in Dark Empire 1 and Krayt's battle with Darth Wheelock III in Star Wars Legacy War. The fight would begin with a clash of words, Sidious likely opening with a degradation of Krayt's Sith heritage, with Krayt retorting by bringing up Palpatine's many failures. Then, in a flash, the two Sith Emperors would ignite their lightsabers and charge at each other, sheets of blue, fans of green, and crimson flames sparking across the landscape. The opening salvo would be savage, both Emperors weaving nets of killing energy in exchanges of ungodly speed, the dark side of the Force itself roiling and bursting and crashing around them. While this flow would remain consistent at first, Krayt's greater physical strength and skill would allow him to quickly gain the upper hand, pushing Sidious back. Realizing he would lose if he continued to rely solely on weapons training, Palpatine would start making more deliberate use of his Force powers, only to have his attacks matched, dispelled, or overpowered at every turn. Krayt actually mocking his efforts, which only infuriates Sidious more. In the end, both would take considerable damage. However, Krayt's strength would be less depleted due to him healing himself with Dark Transfer, whereas Sidious would literally be decaying. No longer able to keep up, Sidious would be unable to defend himself from Krayt, who would take advantage of the opening to disarm his foe and then place his hand upon his chest. Sidious would attempt to make one final, desperate plea for his life, but his words would ring hollow. Unleashing the full power of the Dark Transfer, Krayt would flood Sidious's body with raw energy, resulting in the complete annihilation of his being. As the dust settles upon the battlefield, Sidious's spirit screams in terror as it is hurled into the void, a sound that is quickly overpowered by the reverberations of Krayt's triumphant, booming laughter. I declare Darth Krayt, the Dragon of the Sith, the victor. Well, guys, I hope you enjoyed this finale of the Versus series season 7. Thank you to every single one of you who has stuck with me on this incredible journey. I can't wait to do it again in season 8. As always, please leave your thoughts and questions in the comment section below. May the Force be with you, stay safe, and I'll see you guys later.